Blog Talk Radio.
Hallelujah. You know, these are exciting times to live in. You're living in the day that the prophets prophesied about concerning the future and the end times. And it was a time that they wanted to see themselves, but they couldn't see. They prophesied the heart of God, and it was like them standing in front of a mountain and prophesying, and the prophecy would go to the peak of the mountain, and then they would go on the other side of the mountain and they'd prophesy, and then the peak would come up again. They just saw bits and pieces of their prophecy, but they really did not understand what they were saying a lot of times. They just said what God told them to say. And so when God tells us to say something, we just say it. And I know I have prophesied over some person when I was on the mission field, you know, and you don't know anything about them. And God will give you a part of the knowledge when you speak a word, but you don't really know a lot of times what you're saying into someone's spirit when you speak prophecy, because you just know in part. You just know as much as the Lord will let you know, and but you're prophesying to the people in the secrets that are in their hearts, and God and that person sometimes will be the only person that knows the secret that lies in the heart. And so, but when you prophesy under the authority of Jesus, and God speaks of those secrets in the heart, that person will know and open up like a rose to hear what God has to say. But we're not going to talk about prophecy tonight. We're going to be talking with Marshall Perot. He's not come up yet on the radio, but I believe he'll be up momentarily. Everybody can hear. It sounds great. So we just give God the glory for that. And while we're speaking about Marshall coming up and what we're going to talk about, I do want to pray for the for this meeting. It's going to be an interesting subject because we're going to talk about corporate prayer. And, you know, in so many churches today, the churches no longer come together in corporate prayer. They just come together and they do their service, and then that's it. I see Marshall's up, so I won't talk for just a few more moments. But corporate prayer is one of the most important things that a church can do, and that's coming together and praying in one accord with the people in the church for the needs of the church, for the needs of the city, the government, for other churches in the city, for the pastors, for the elders, for the members, for all of the various things, the finances that go on in churches. For God to choose the right leadership for your church. And there's just so much that somebody can pray for when we talk about corporate prayer and intercession for the congregation. And I know that Brother Marshall has a lot to say about these things because he's an intercessor in his church, and they've been meeting for years, I understand, to pray for their church and their city and their country. And so I'm very interested to hear his take on this. And so one of the things that we do need to pray for tonight is that God will gather the intercessors to this radio program, and that he will give us all spiritual ears and spiritual eyes to see and hear what the Spirit is saying in these end times, because if you don't hear it according to the way the Lord has it, then you will be spiritually deaf, or you will be confused, and you will not understand these messages that we're doing up on Blog Talk, because we keep them pretty centered around Jesus and the Word and our submission to the Word. And, of course, there are demons that act in churches and spiritual warfare. There's always a resistance, and Christians must learn spiritual warfare and how to resist the devil, because the Bible said if you resist the devil, he will flee from you. And what I've found is many people don't bother to resist the devil because they don't understand that they have to do that. They just say, well, you know, I'm a Christian and I'm protected. I know Jesus. Well, that's not New Testament covenant. The New Testament covenant tells us that Jesus is more sufficient for us and able to do all things for us, but it shows us in a spiritual relationship with Him, walking under His divine protection, but at the same time, we are shown in, I'm talking about believers, are shown in the New Testament as a great spiritual warfare coming against us. And that would be Satan and his host. But it shows that when they come against us, the Bible says that if we're vigilant, that they will have to flee. If we resist them, they will have to flee. If we pray, they have to flee. If we use our armor and our prayer weapons, they have to flee. And most of all, if we use the name of Jesus. And so there's a lot that is entailed to a Christian life. And you might say, well, Pastor Pat, I don't understand why Jesus did it that way. Why doesn't he just protect me? Well, he wants you to have a relationship with him. And he also wants you to know his word. And if you become a passive Christian, you will be left behind in terms of knowledge and in terms of protection. I like what Marshall talks about a lot of times when he testifies. He said, I was in a Christian many years. And he said, and I didn't even know about sin and demons and the effect that they would have on my life until years later. He went to a ministry down in Georgia, and he learned about how demons can make you sick, and they can bring sin into your life and all of that stuff. And he right away changed his life forms and his lifestyle. And he says he got in the Bible and he studied. And now he is standing against the powers of the devil for himself and his church and his family, which is very, very important in prayer. And so when we do those things, the Bible tells us that that's when God is able to open up for us to, he's able to open up to us for the blessings that he's promised us under the new covenant. So I see Marshall Perot, and we're going to go and get Marshall on the line, and I know because of the subject matter that we're in tonight that Marshall is going to have some things that he wants to put in context with you so you'll understand where he's coming from. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to just listen and learn like you are. So, Marshall, are you there?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
I hear you very clearly. And you can hear me too, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, well, I'm going to turn the platform over to you and let you talk about what God's laid on your heart for the ears of the people. But before you do, let's just open with prayer.
Amen.
And you go ahead and pray for the program and bind the interference and everything.
Well, Father God, we come joyfully and boldly before your throne of grace because of the blood of Jesus. And we ask for all of us, Father God, that you, Father of glory, will grant each of us a fresh spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus, the Word of God, who's come in the flesh, that the eyes of our understanding may be enlightened, that all of us will know what is the hope of your calling, what is the riches of the glory of your inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of your power to usward who believe according to the working of your mighty power, even what you wrought in Christ when you raised him from the dead and set him at your own right hand in the heavenly places, Father God, as it is written in Ephesians chapter 1. And you said, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world but also in that which is to come, and how you put all things under Messiah's feet, under Jesus' feet, and given him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. And Father, if there be any outstanding sin, any spirit of contention, or any sin whatsoever, any spirit of strife or scorning, I take responsibility and I repent, Father, for me and for those I can stand in for. Please forgive us and deliver us. And Father, we do receive your blood by faith, even to the ground of our hearts. And it's because of that blood, the blood of the Lamb of God, the Lord Jesus Christ, who is God come in the flesh, the Word of God come in the flesh. For in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That we can come before you, Father. And we ask you to guide us, and we ask that you write your law, your words, in our hearts. Because we can't do this. But we're so grateful, Father, that you offered to send the Holy Spirit. And Jesus prayed to you that you would send the Holy Spirit to be with us forever in John chapter 14, I believe it is. So thank you, Holy Spirit, for coming. Father, we do ask for the Holy Spirit to come and to teach all of us and to write the Word of God, the Word of God in our hearts the way you promised, Father, even in Jeremiah 31, chapter 31, verses 31 to 34, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. And every ungodly spirit that would seek to interfere with the Word of God going forth, every scrambling spirit, every spirit of voice, every spirit that would interfere with the Word of God going forth, your demonic assignments are null and void. Every curse coming against anyone listening, in Jesus' name, we cancel those assignments because Jesus became a curse for us. For cursed is every man that hangeth on the tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. And we choose to remain dead to sin. And because we are dead to sin, the enemy has no legal right to us, in Jesus' name. And Jesus, who has all power in heaven and in earth, as it is written, Matthew 28:18, says unto us in Luke 10:19-20, behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Notwithstanding, rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice that your names are written in heaven. We rejoice, Father, that our names are written in heaven. We rejoice, Lord Jesus, that you've engraved our names in the palms of your hand, the palms of the Word of God's hand, who came in the flesh. And we thank you for keeping us as the apple of your eye. Help us to keep you, Lord Jesus, as the apple of our eye. Help us to fix our eyes on Jesus, because we're not here to hear Marshall or hear Pat per se. We're here to hear you, Lord, because your words are forever settled in heaven. Heaven and earth are going to change, but your words never change. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And we praise and bless you and honor you and reverence you, Lord Jesus. And so every ungodly spirit that would seek to interfere with this call, including stealing a single word of God from our hearts and minds in Jesus' name, from henceforth and forevermore, for each one of us and all that's connected and related to us, your demonic assignments are null and void and canceled in Jesus' name. We command you to go where Jesus Christ of Nazareth tells you to go, and be mute, have nothing further to do with us. And we say all thoughts captive and subject to the complete obedience of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth in Jesus' name, by the power of the Holy Spirit, because of the blood of the covenant. For we overcome the accuser of the brethren by the blood of the Lamb, the word of our testimony. And we love not our lives unto the death. That is to say, we don't like these physical lives anything above what we like about you, Lord. You are our real life. Christ is our life. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, Lord. So Pat asked me to share a little bit, and And the Lord has been teaching me, and I've been gleaning from those. He says, you'll know them by their fruit. And I found a couple of saints that have had good fruit in their lives. Praise God for that. And I need to learn. And so I figured, you know, I can learn from them, and I thank the Lord for sending the Holy Spirit to teach me, because ultimately he's our teacher. He taught them, and he's teaching me too. So some of the things I have, I've gleaned from a few others, and some are just out of the book, as the Holy Spirit has opened my heart and my eyes to see and respond. So the question is how to intercede, and how can we do it effectively? How can we know that we're going to get what we're looking for? And how can we know the enemy's not going to beat up on us? Because you hear about, you know, some Christians saying, oh, the devil's beating up on me or whatever. Well, he's out there. He's busy, but he doesn't have to. And so that's the challenge. And the biggest challenge of all is to appropriate what's written, for example, in Galatians 2:20 and Romans chapter 6. And in Galatians 2:20 says, for I am crucified with Christ. You know, we're those of us who have accepted Jesus and have been obedient to the degree we know and have gone through the outward sign of the baptism in water. I'm not sure that saves us. There's some people who believe that, and there's one or two scriptures that seem to imply that. But from what I read, I think we're saved by the baptism into the body of Christ. And when we're in Jesus, the enemy can't touch us. Of course, Jesus is, you know, he did take the sin of the world on himself, but he doesn't have any anymore. It says he knew no sin, and now he is that spotless lamb. He doesn't have sin anymore, so it's a big challenge. I'm not sure I can define that specifically, but at least let's put it this way. We have a heart not to sin anymore. I think that's what he's looking for. He wants us to have a heart like King David, who made some blunders along the way, as we've all probably made, because if somebody says they've not sinned, you know, they're a liar, but we've all messed up. I have anyway. But King David, after he was convicted by the Holy Spirit in the matter about Bathsheba, he repented. And he genuinely repented. He really didn't want to go back there anymore. So I think that's what the Lord's looking for. He wants us to find out where we miss the mark and say, whoops, I'm sorry, Dad, Heavenly Father, I don't want to miss the mark anymore. And we're so grateful for the Spirit of adoption. So I'm going to try and be a little bit more organized. I'm just going to go through some thoughts as the Lord was giving me some in preparation for this chat. So if anybody wants to take notes, I have a couple of scriptures that may be helpful. And for God to hear our prayers, that is the true God, the Creator God, God the Father, to hear our prayers, we need to, A, start with making sure we're born from above. And confess with our mouth Jesus is our Lord, and believe in our hearts, not just our heads, that God has raised him from the dead. And then we are adopted as his children. We are brought in as co-heirs, joint heirs with Jesus. But in case we missed the mark, as I did this evening, even briefly, help me, Lord, we have 1 John 1:9, which I am so grateful for. If any man's... Help me, Lord. If we confess our faults, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So that's the first step. Once we're in the body of Christ, if we've messed up, is to make sure we quick clean up the mess. I heard a man say that, you know, if a woman has a lovely dress and she's walking outside and somebody drives by in a puddle and gets it all splattered with mud, she probably doesn't wear that for several days on end without, you know, going to make sure it gets cleaned. And that's kind of what I need to be aware of, and I'm sure we all do, that if we step in a mud puddle spiritually, we need to repent. And I'm going to go through a couple of scriptures that I think a lot of people know, but some of them are a little challenging, but I'm going to start off in Psalm 66. And Psalm 66:18 says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. Now, that doesn't mean a sinner can't come to him and say, I repent. for salvation, because it says, call upon the name of the Lord and you'll be saved. It means, you know, we can't come to him in fellowship, in covenant, if we've been living in covenant with another spirit. God is a jealous God. He really doesn't like it when we hang out with the enemy. So I don't want to hang out with the enemy either, even though I've been known to occasionally brush shoulders with him and sometimes let him in, and I shouldn't do that anymore. So help me, Father. And then John 9:31, this is the man who was healed of his blindness by Jesus. The man was born blind. And the Pharisees were having a really hard time because they really couldn't imagine that Jesus really was who he, or maybe they didn't want to believe he was who he is, the Messiah. But this man, they asked him some questions, and he said, and this is scripture, this is the word of God that's forever settled in heaven. In John 9:31, he's got some good advice here. Now we know that God heareth not sinners, but if any man be a worshiper of God and doeth his will, him he heareth. So I think it would behoove us to be a worshiper of God. And if you look up in the Hebrew, the word worship in the Old Testament, and there are several scriptures that point to it, even in the King James, it's clear enough in Psalm 95, I think it's verse 6, and a bunch of others, but it says to bow down. And I know in years gone by, when I went to the Episcopal Church, they had these little kneelers, and we would routinely bow down, but it wasn't a heartfelt thing, it was just a what people did. But I think he wants us to do that of our own free will. And it does say, the name of Jesus is the name above all names. And at his name, every knee will bow, including Satan's. And every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Every single person, Adolf Hitler, whoever you think of as not being perhaps the most godly person in the world, they will be bowing down to Jesus because the scripture says so. So it might behoove us, since we're created by him and for him and for his good pleasure, to start practicing that now, provided the Lord has given us health in our bodies to be able to do so. But if there's a desire, quite often there's a way. Even our 80-something-year-old pastor, who may not be as limber as he was when he was 50 or 60 or whatever, I've seen him get down and bow down. So if he can do it, I think a few of us can do that too. There's another one for husbands, and this one I need to be particularly aware of since I'm a husband. But it says in 1 Peter 3:7, help the Lord to find that easily. And that comes right after Hebrews, after James, 1 Peter 3:7. Likewise, ye husbands, dwell with them, that is your brides, dwell with them according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife, as unto the weaker vessel. I don't think that's weaker in emotions or anything or whatever. I think it's physically weaker in some areas. And being heirs together of the grace of God, that your prayers be not hindered. If we're not in harmony on a horizontal level, it's kind of hard for us to be in harmony on a vertical level with our Creator, to put it mildly. And just to reinforce that, and to make it a little bit clearer, I think this makes it super-duper clear how God hears our prayers. I'm going to read several verses here out of 1 John chapter 3. And this is really amazing. So help us, Father. 1 John chapter 3, starting verse 13 to the end of the chapter. Marvel not, my brethren, if the world hates you. You may have noticed that. If you love Jesus, sometimes you're not appreciated by everybody. We know that, at least the demons in them, let's put it that way. We know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. In verse 15 of 1 John 3, whosoever hateth his brother, that is any other human being, is a murderer. That's pretty strong. And you know that no murderer hath eternal life abiding in him. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. But whoso hath this world's good, and seeth his brother have need, and shutteth up his bowels of compassion from him, how dwelleth the love of God in him? My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. And hereby we know that we are of the truth, and shall assure our hearts before him. For if our heart condemn us not, God is greater than our heart. Wait a minute. Oh, I read that wrong. Forgive me. 1 John 3, verse 20. For if our heart condemn us, God is greater than our heart and knoweth all things. Thank you, Lord. And then the last few verses here, starting verse 21. Beloved, if our heart condemn us not, then have we confidence toward God. And that's where we need to be. Help us, Lord. And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him. Isn't that good? Because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. And this is his commandment. This is the Father's commandment, Father God. This is his commandment that we should believe on the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave us commandment. He that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him, and he in him. We dwell in Jesus, and Christ dwells in us. Christ in us, the hope of glory. And hereby we know that he abideth in us by the Spirit which he hath given us. So thank you, Lord, for sending your Holy Spirit. So those are some basic sort of ground rules for, I mean, just common sense. If I was a teenage son and I had a dad who asked me to cut the grass or something, and I just, you know, and he said, you know, you do a good job, I'm going to be gone for a week or something, you take care of this for me and I'm going to pay you whatever, $40 or something when I get back. And then he comes back and finds the grass is, you know, up to his knees or something. It might not grow that fast in a week, but, you know, whatever. And so, you know, the old man, he doesn't really expect me to obey him. You know, I have a feeling a natural father wouldn't be quite as inclined to give that son $40 if he didn't do what he asked him to do. So let's just, you know, that's just common sense. And so that's, you know, we're made in the image of God, and God the Father is a father. And it says in Hebrews 12 that if he doesn't chasten us, then we're not real children. He does know how to give us spanks, as it were, in different ways. And some people have a little bit of a problem with that, but that's his character. If you hear about the name of God, and he's loving and just and merciful, but he will not forgive anyone if they don't repent, don't line up with him. And then he will. Then the blood covers it. Then it's all taken care of. And thank God for the blood of the Lamb. There's so many people that are getting to learn about that. Well, I was reading in a little booklet, it's a compilation of Smith Wigglesworth's sermons or whatever, called Greater Faith. And in there he brought to my understanding something I hadn't really thought about before. It says in Romans 1:17, the just shall live by faith. Which goes back to Habakkuk, which really says the just shall live by his faith, that is the faith of the Son of God, the faith of the Messiah. But it's really true. If you know that your sins are forgiven, you know that it's like it never happened, you know, that you are indeed become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, it makes you much bolder to come before the throne of grace. It makes you much bolder to come against the enemy because you know he can't touch you if you are washed in the blood. So there's a couple other verses in Romans that they are looking at just briefly. And one is really critical. And there's some people, I mean, I missed this decades. How did I miss it so long, Lord? Anyway, it says in Romans 3:25. Let me see if I can put my, here it is. I should have that memorized. Well, I'll go back a verse, Romans 3:24-25. Being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation, that is a substitute and a sacrifice, through faith in his blood, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are passed through the forbearance of God. The sins are remitted, they're removed, as far as the east is from the west, for the sins that are past. They're not ongoing sins. We're not continuing to lie. We're not continuing to steal. We're not continuing to whatever is a sin, fornication or covetousness or whatever it is. We can't do that anymore. And then it's by the faith in the blood of the Lamb, but it's The amazing thing is Jesus has faith in his blood, because the scripture I started with in Galatians 2:20 says, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. And as I'm just going to refer to it in Matthew 20:19, Jesus, before it happened, foretold of his crucifixion. And also in Matthew 26, one of the first couple of verses, I think it's verse 3, talks about he says he's going to be crucified. The Son of Man is going to be crucified. So he foretold his crucifixion and resurrection in many places, and he didn't do it as a lark. It wasn't optional. He said, Father, if it be possible, take this cup from me. He took our cup of bitterness that we might receive his cup of blessing. He took all of our curses, if we'll let him have them, that we might receive all that he paid for, all his blessings. And it's awesome. And all of this is groundwork. A lot of this everybody knows already, but I really love the scriptures in Romans 5. Oh, I'm going to read one at the end of Romans 4 first, the last verse of Romans 4. We're talking about being justified. And Derek Prince talks about this. It means we're just as if we never sinned. That tends to make one a whole lot bolder. We're not poor, unworthy sinners saved by grace. We were, all of us that have accepted Jesus, saved by his blood, by the faith in his blood. That's that grace that we fix it. That's the grace of God, that he would shed his blood for us. But we're made just as if we never sinned, but it's also because he rose again. If he didn't rise again, then our faith is vain. He definitely is alive right now, and that's the good news. And it says in Romans 4:25, who was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification, or made just as if we never sinned. And then going down a couple of verses, Romans chapter 5, 8 to 10. But God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if when we were enemies, and we all were, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more than being now help me to read that right, Lord. Verse 10 of Romans 5. For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. We're made at one with our Creator by his life. And, of course, Jesus lives by the Father. And this is a bit of a stretch, but in the beginning of 1 John, it says our fellowship is with the Father and the Son. And it says in Hosea 2:22, I think it is, hear the corn, the wine, and the oil. The corn is the seed, and Jesus is that Word of God. He is the seed. Hear the corn, the wine, the blood of Jesus, the blood of God is speaking on our behalf, and the oil, that's a reference of the Holy Spirit. So we need to hear the Word of God, who is that seed planted in us. We need to hear the blood of God speaking on our behalf, saying, he's forgiven. He's repented of his sins. Devil, you can't touch him. And you need to hear the oil, the Holy Spirit, guiding us and teaching us into all truth and showing us things to come. So, praise the Lord. It's a bit of a stretch, but this is fits in with the Galatians 2:20. And I this is a verse I've been meditating on the whole chapter 6 of Romans is very challenging, but just going to mention verse 8 here. It says, if we be dead with Christ, I mean dead to sin, we believe that we shall also live with him, which is confirmed in verse 11 down below. It says, likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. We have to count ourselves dead to worry, dead to fear of evil, dead to fear of what's going to happen tomorrow, dead to every ungodly spirit, dead to selfishness. Selfishness is pretty nasty little thing. Dead to pride. Hey, I got it all figured out. No. The Lord knows everything. Jesus has all wisdom, but it's available to us because he's made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. Anyway, and then it says in Luke 9:22, this is about the taking up your cross daily. Let's see if I can put my Luke 9. I probably should have had these somehow written out, but I just made a note, and bear with me. Luke 9:22. Is that where it is? 22, oh, 23. Luke 9:23. And he said unto them all, if any man will, Jesus speaking, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. That's what I need to do, and that's what I think he wants all of us to do. So then I'm just going to refer to a couple other ones here. If you've heard the teaching in the Word, and maybe you've heard me share about it somewhat, about communion, and this is something I've only in the last few years begun to really appreciate a little bit more. Communion is really, really important, because that's how he protects us, and that's how we have intimate fellowship with him. And that's how he empowers us, and will fellowship with us. I mean, if you read how important the blood was in the Old Covenant, in Exodus, I think it's 24, it talks about how Moses and Aaron and Aaron's two sons, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders, they sanctified themselves. You know, they went through their ritual ceremony, and they there were sacrifices made of oxen or whatever. Blood was shed, and then they went, and they actually saw God, it says. And I believe that's the pre-incarnate Word, because it says he's the visible representation of the invisible God, and he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He may not appear the same in every place, but anyway, they saw God, and they ate with him and drank with him. And that's what communion's all about, is about having fellowship with our Creator and getting his instructions. There's a brother in the fellowship I'm involved in who has been pursuing the Lord for a couple of decades, and the Lord's given him some amazing insights, and I'm going to just share, because this is not actually the same as, I believe, having actual physically partaking of communion with the elements is ideal. There have been people I've heard about who were thrown in prison and given nothing to eat or drink, and they would have communion daily by faith without elements, you know, because they knew how important it was. And, you know, it's the word of our testimony, but it's the blood. Ideally, I like to have the elements, but Pete got this revelation. It's quite amazing. And he's had opportunity to have people just, he said, say this after me. And he would say it one phrase, and they're all based on different references. And based on Colossians 2:14, it says, I believe in my heart, I confess and repent and renounce all my sins, and I believe in my heart they are all nailed to the cross. And based on 1 Corinthians 1:18, where it talks about the power of the cross, it says, I believe in my heart that the cross of Christ is the power of God to destroy all of my sins, to destroy my sins. And based on Hebrews 10, starting at verse 19, I believe in my heart, therefore having boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and a living way which he hath consecrated for me through the veil, that is to say his flesh, I draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, and I receive now by faith the blood of Jesus right now to the ground of my heart. Now here he just asked the Holy Spirit to come. I always ask the Father in Jesus' name, because I see that's how Jesus asked us to do it, but people have a different way of doing things. But the Lord meets us all where we are. Anyway, he says, come, Holy Spirit, fill me now. Wash me of my sins and cleanse me of all unrighteousness by the blood of Jesus in my heart. Come, Holy Spirit. And I hold fast your confession of faith without wavering, for he that promised is faithful to perform it. And then based on Romans 6:4, he says, I believe in my heart, as I'm one with Christ on the cross, my sin nature is now destroyed, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, I'm now also walking in newness of Zoe life. The life as God himself is life. And I believe in my heart I'm no longer a slave of sin, for he who died by faith has been freed from sin. That's one thing. Corpses don't have demons stay with them. They leave. they're looking for a new home. So if we choose to remain dead to sin, then the demons have to leave. It's just as if we're a corpse. We reckon ourselves dead to all sins. We don't give them an open door to beat up on us. And then Hebrews 12:24 really fits in, because that blood of sprinkling of Jesus speaketh better things than that of Abel. It says, Father, forgive them. They didn't know what they're doing. And in John 6:56, after one has communion, Jesus said, he that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. And then the amazing thing, if we're dwelling in him, when you find out what his name is, and it says in Isaiah 9, verses 4 to 7, it's wonderful. wonderful is the operative word. The Hebrew word for wonderful is pele, which is the same as the word for secret. It's the same root word anyway. If you look them up in a concordance, I'm no Hebrew scholar, but the Holy Spirit prompted me to do that. And it's I guess it was in the footnote of one of the study Bibles, so it wasn't just the Holy Spirit. But it's amazing. But he taught this other person how important that is. And there's a section in Judges about Samson's father and mother seeing this pre-incarnate Christ. They call him the angel of the Lord, and how he went up in this flame of fire up into the sky when they had an offering. And they realized that before they just thought he was a messenger, just a human being, and then they realized this was a supernatural being, that he would ascend in the flame. And they fell down on their faces with holy reverence, which is a good thing to do when you encounter the living God. But he was asking, can we say what your name is? He said, why do you ask after my name, seeing it is secret? His name is secret, and Jesus' name is secret. It talks about here in Isaiah 9, verse 20 and verse 4, just to get the flow of it. For thou hast broken the yoke of his burden, and the staff of his shoulder, and the rod of his oppressor, as in the day of Midian. And there's a lot of richness in here. For every battle of the warrior is with confused noise and garments rolled in blood, but this shall be with burning of fuel of fire. In verse 5. In verse 6, for unto us, and everybody knows this, for unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. And his name shall be called Wonderful. His name is Secret, Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Jesus is the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end. Upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom to order and to establish with judgment and with justice from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. Thank you, Lord, for your zeal. But his name is Secret. And then, guess what? Psalm 91 fits. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. Surely shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noise and pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings thou shalt trust. The feathers there, I think, are referring to the cherubs that are overshadowing the mercy seat, because we're washed in his blood. We are in him, as it were, covered by his mercy, covered by the blood. Those are those wings. It's not like God is some winged being per se, because we're made in his image and we don't have wings per se. But that's my understanding. It's referring to the mercy seat. It's referring to his grace, his mercy, and the blood of the Lamb. And because of all the promises in Psalm 91, it said, he'll give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. And thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon, thou shalt trample under feet. And because he set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he hath known my name. And when you have the blood on your lips, you have the name of I Am on your lips. And just as surely as the Israelites were protected in Egypt by the blood on the lintel and post of that type and shadow of the Lamb of God, and they were, and just as surely as there was not one feeble one among them, as it says in Psalm 105, I think it's verse 37, because they ate the roasted lamb, when we partake of communion, we don't have to be feeble or weak anymore. We don't have to be sick anymore. And when we have the blood on our lips, the opening of these temples of the Holy Spirit, the enemy has to pass over. He can't touch us. He can't hurt us. Because that's the same thing. It was a type and a shadow in Egypt, but now it's become real because Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Behold the Lamb of God in John 1:29. Jesus is that Lamb of God. And it also refers to this in Ephesians 2:4 and following. Yes, I should read a couple of those. I don't want to read the whole Bible tonight, but it's hard not to at least touch on the main points here. Ephesians 2, starting at verse 4, "But God, who is rich in mercy for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ, by grace you are saved, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus." That's the same thing as the end of Psalm 91. We're raised up together. We have to be crucified, like we were talking about in Romans 6, 8. If we died with him, we'll be raised with him, right? So that's the same deal. And he raises us up together with Christ Jesus. If we've died with him, then we're raised with him. And then we have this amazing boldness. And then I have to share something, because when Pat first said, "I want you to teach about intercession," I was like, "Oh, Lord." I heard someone share something powerful about intercession. I said, "Where is that?" So I asked the Lord, because I didn't remember where it was. And I really didn't. And the Lord said, "Ezekiel 9. I said, "Well, that's right after that." I don't know if anyone has read Ezekiel 8 recently, but it is, blood-curdling is the right word, but it's disgusting that all these supposed great men of God are worshiping demons connected with the temple of the Lord. It's not a happy thing. I'm just going to read one verse from that, because he wants us to be simple concerning what's evil and wise concerning what's good, it says in the end of Romans. But just as a backdrop for why the verse chapter 9 in Ezekiel is so amazing. If you read Ezekiel 8 in the King James, you'll see it. I mean, it's just awful. He's showing Ezekiel these horrendous things. And in verse 16 of Ezekiel 8, it says, "And he brought me into the inner court of the Lord's house. And behold, at the door of the temple of the Lord, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men with their backs toward the temple of the Lord and their faces toward the east, and they worship the S-U-N, they worship the sun toward the east. Almost all false religions worship the created sun instead of the Son of God, instead of Father God and the Lord Jesus." And that's, these are supposed to be men of God. They're in the temple of the Lord, and that's what's so disturbing about this passage. But then you're going to see when we get to Ezekiel 9 why that's an important backdrop. So starting at verse 3 of Ezekiel 9, "And the glory of the God of Israel was gone up from the church whereon he was to the threshold of the house. And he called to the man clothed with linen, which had the writer's inkhorn on his side." And in verse 4, this is where I'm going with this. "And the Lord said unto him, Go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. And to the others he said in mine hearing, Go ye after him through the city and smite, let not your eyes spare, neither have ye pity." So in other words, the ones that were disgusted by the abominations that were going on had a mark put on them to protect them. But the ones that were, it doesn't really matter. You can worship any god you want. The ones that were not zealous for the Lord, they didn't have the mark on them, and they were taken out. That's basically what it's saying here. "Let not your eye spare, neither have ye pity. Slay utterly old and young, both maids and little children and women. But come not near any man upon whom is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary." Then they began at the ancient men which were before the house, the ones we just were reading about. So they were taken out by the Lord. He is a jealous God. He does not like when people worship demons. That's basically, he does not want us to have fellowship with demons. That's what it boils down to. It says, whoever you submit yourselves to obey, you're his servants. And we don't have to get down on our knees, as it's talking about when people take the mark of the beast, although we may be getting to that in this age. It says, if we don't receive the mark of the beast, we might not be able to buy or sell. Well, the Lord's going to have to provide for us. So, but that is one of the protections for those who are intercessors, is when you have a heart for what bothers the Lord, if that bothers you too, he puts a mark on you, and the enemy can't touch you. And I believe that mark is sort of confirmed in Isaiah 26:3, that will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. If our mind is stayed on Jesus, and we're not spending all of our time, you know, we have to live in this world in the natural, but as long as we're not preoccupied with all these other things that can try and steal the word of God from our hearts or cause it to be not effective, he can use us. It's his plan. I didn't come up with a plan. It was his plan that the seed of the woman is going to crush the head of the serpent, and Jesus has done all that he had to do. So praise God for that. You know, it's, what does it say? He said, Father, I finished the work thou gavest me to do, and for this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. That's part of the reason he came. A big part of it was to destroy the works of the devil. But when we have that mark on us, and it's also confirmed in Exodus 12:13, we say, when I see the blood upon the houses where you are, the plague shall not be upon you to destroy us. When we have his blood on us, that's a mark to protect us from the enemy. And in Psalm 86:17, the psalmist was asking to be protected. So if we're interceding, it's nice to know the enemy's not going to come up and beat up on us here. So that's why I'm going to all this trouble of explaining this. Psalm 86, the last verse in Psalm 86, show me a token for good, that they which hate me, the demons which hate me, may see it and be ashamed, because thou, Lord, hast holpen me and comforted me. He helps us and comforts us. He sends the Comforter, the Holy Ghost. He helps us because he protects us by the blood of the Lamb. And then in help me, Lord Jesus. Philippians 1:28. This is all in reference to the word token, which is found in Exodus. I didn't read Exodus 12:13. I really should read it. It's just such an important verse. Exodus 12:13. Because there was a man who prayed this verse over his wife after she'd had a cerebral aneurysm, and she was dying. I mean, she's technically on her way to exiting. And he said, Lord, what do I do? He asked the Lord. It's a good thing to do if you don't know what to do. Ask the Lord. He asked the Lord, and the Lord said, plead. Exodus 12:13. I don't know what it is. So the Lord, like, wrote it out in front of him. And he said, and the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt. And that man's wife lived, even though medically it was impossible. So this is, the blood is more powerful than I think I have a clue, but this is the blood of God. And if you don't, in the King James, it says that in Acts chapter 20, verse 28. I'm just going to read it because it's such an, I think a lot of the newer, so-called newer translations, the so-called corrected translations, somehow managed to change this. Acts 20, 28, take heed therefore unto yourselves and all the flock over which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers to feed the church of God which he hath purchased with his own blood. This is not just the blood of a man, which would be pretty amazing. This is the blood of God. I mean, if the Israelites were protected by the blood of a created little lamb, how much more the blood of the Lamb of God, who is God, come in the flesh? Don't you think that can protect you? It sure has protected me, and I'm so grateful. I'm very grateful for your blood, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And And an important aspect of the communion is that, of course, he gives us his righteousness. It talks about that in Romans 5:17 about the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness. It talks about it very powerfully. He renders unto man his righteousness in the oldest book in the Bible, in Job, chapter 33, I think it's verse 26 or 25, somewhere in there. But he gives us his gift of righteousness, and it talks in Proverbs 10 and Proverbs 11 that righteousness delivereth from death. So if we've received his gift of righteousness, we don't have to worry about exiting this world prematurely. And it says in many places in the scripture, but it says he made peace by the blood of his cross in Ephesians chapter 2, around verse 13. That whole section there is pretty awesome. I've read a little bit of it before, but that whole section from Hebrews 2, from verse 4 to 14, when you have time, you'll want to read that. It's awesome. But it says in Hebrews, the last chapter of Hebrews, chapter 13, verses 20 and 21, "And the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect," that is, complete, "in every good work, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight." When you're having communion, I don't have time to get into this right now, but it says he's looking at us. It says in Genesis 49:12, his eyes are red with wine. He's looking at us. It's sometime I'll get into that again in more depth, but I can assure you he knows everything that's going on. That's just to confirm it. I mean, he obviously knows the number of hairs on each one of our heads and the billions of people on the earth, so it's not hard for him to know what we're thinking or what's going on. And then it says in Proverbs 28, verse 1, "The righteous are bold as a lion." By the way, when I was in Ezekiel, I should have mentioned this is kind of goes part and parcel with intercession and the fact that he puts a mark on us to protect us. I should just read that to you. Where is it? It's Ezekiel 22:30. It's a couple chapters after I was reading before. 22:30. This is what the Lord is looking for. "And I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me for the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found none. Therefore have I poured out mine indignation upon them. I have consumed them with the fire of my wrath." So we don't want him to have to do that, but there is a judgment coming on the earth. We all know that. And we do also know that the judgment begins with the house of God. I think that's in Peter, First Peter 4, I think. But we need to intercede for one another. We need to intercede for the body of Christ, and we need to intercede for the land we're living in, because the blood is crying out from the ground, for vengeance. The 50 million or whatever it is babies that have been slaughtered in worship to the God of convenience or whatever. "Forgive us, Father, for against you and you only have we sinned," in Jesus' name. We need to stand in like Daniel did, and he repented, and for his sins and the sins of his forefathers, and there's nothing wrong with doing that. He's looking for someone to do that, to take that responsibility and repent. He doesn't want everybody to be passing the buck, like the first Adam said, "Well, that woman you gave me, she made me," or whatever, trying to blame God and Eve at the same time. I've been there. It's the fallen nature. We don't want to go there anymore. The fallen nature needs to remain on the cross. That's how hideous, if you think about the horrendous death that Jesus died, that's how much God hates sin, because he came in the likeness of sinful flesh. Not that flesh by itself is sinful, but it sure picked up enough demons after the fall. Help me, Lord. And then we have the privilege. once we know that we're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, once we know in Proverbs 28:1 that the righteous are bold as a lion, we can come boldly before the throne of grace, like it says in Hebrews 4:16. And he tells us how to pray. And this is something I missed for decades. Isaiah 43:26. Let me read it to you. You can all look this up later if you want. But Isaiah 43:26, put me in remembrance. Let us plead together. Declare thou that thou mayest be justified. So we are going boldly before the throne of grace. We're pleading together with who? With Jesus. Who is Jesus? He's the Word of God, right? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And it's confirmed in Revelation 19:13. His name is the Word of God. He wears a vesture dipped in blood. And when we're in him, we have a, you know, we're covered by his blood. So the way this works is we go with the Word of God, who is Jesus, the Word, to Father God. And there's a couple of scriptures, and this is something that I never quite realized, but there's, I have to give credit where credit is due. There's a fellow who was a Southern Baptist, and he just stands on the written word, and he's seen profound miracles, because it says in Psalm 138:2 that God esteems his word above all his name. So what he does, the way he prays, and this is the way I've been learning how to pray, and people do it in many Christian circles, you know, they say, you know, the prayer of agreement is so powerful, but they don't necessarily, you know, call the Father in remembrance specifically, because that is the Word of God. That is Jesus. If two of you on earth agree to touching anything you ask my Father, he will give it them. Now, we have to ask according to his will. But if we do, it's a done deal. Then we have to ask in faith, nothing wavering, like it says in James chapter 1, verses 5 to 7. We have to ask of God with nothing wavering. It says, if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask of God to give it to all men liberally and abrade not, and it will be given him. But we have to ask without any reservations. Well, I hope it's his will. If it's, we have to find out by reading the book what his will is. And then we have to ask according to that will, according to his written word. And then there's so many places. And there's some people that pray, you know, in other circles, that they might pray to saints or pray to Mary. And that's not endorsed by the Word of God. That's called necromancy. We're not supposed to pray to dead people, people that have died and gone on. It's an abomination to the Lord. I'm sorry, but it's just the way it is in the book. I can find that later on, but that is necromancy. I think it's in Deuteronomy 18 or somewhere in there. It talks about in other places. It's also in Leviticus. But he absolutely detests that. But he tells us how to pray. And he says in John 16, verses 23 to 24, I guess I should read it verbatim. I have a paraphrase in my head, but that is not the whole. And my paraphrase doesn't work. It's, you know, per se. I mean, it's, if I'm, anyway. He told us how to pray. John 16, Jesus speaking, red letters. Starting verse 23, in that day that Jesus has gone back to heaven, in that day you shall ask me nothing. We're not even supposed to pray to Jesus. I'm sorry, but that's what he said. Verily, verily, and this is a man who cannot lie. God can't lie. Jesus is God. Verily, verily, I say unto you, whatsoever you shall ask the Father in my name, he will give it you. And I believe in his name is meaning in covenant with him, because we have his name on our lips, and he said before Abraham was, I am. In John 8:58, and I am is written as the word token is in Hebrew, in the same first and last letters. The first letter of the Hebrew alphabet is Aleph. It speaks of a sacrifice. It looks like a cross, a tipped over cross, like a Scottish flag type cross. And then the other name, the other letter of I am, looks like a door. And Jesus said in John 10, verses 7 and 9, I am the door. And then it's in the book all over the place that he's the door, he's the gate, he's the, you know, who was it? Jacob had a dream and he saw heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending on this ladder. Well, he's that open door. He's the gate to heaven. He's the only gate. It's not multiple gates. There's only one gate. There's only one door. There's no other name given among men under heaven by which we must be saved, like it says in in Acts 10, I think it's around verse 12. And it says in John 14:6 that Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. So we have to go to the Father to get our answers, but we go with Jesus. We go through that door. We go through the veil, through his flesh, and that's what the communion is about, and we go by the blood of Jesus that's speaking, Father, forgive them. They didn't know what they were doing. So the sins are removed. We become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, and we become bold as a lion, and we go in and we ask him according to his will, and then our answers are guaranteed by God. And then we don't have to ask wavering. Then we don't have to ask, oh, Father, if it be your will. We ask, Father, we know what's your will, so we thank you for doing it. And that's what this man down in Texas, Thurman Scrivener, if anybody's interested, his website is tlsm.org. I'm not saying he's perfect, but he's had awesome fruit. And they said, you'll know them by their fruit. But he stood on the Word of God, only the Word of God, for his granddaughter when, medically speaking, she could not have lived, and she's running and playing today. So, and many thousands of other people he's prayed for based on the written Word, and God has honored that Word over and over. In John 15:7, Jesus says, this is conditional, if you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. But we ask according to his will, but we ask what we will. And in John 14:13-14, Jesus said, whatever you ask in my name, meaning ask the Father, in Jesus' name, meaning in covenant, whatever you ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. That's pretty much a blank check. But we don't want to get too carried away with it. But it's people have had extraordinary things. There was a woman who prayed for her daughter, based, I think it was on that scripture. She'd had terrible eczema for 8 years, and she had terrible scars. She'd scratched and clawed her skin. And once she found out what the sin was that brought this into her child's life, and yes, the curse calls us does not come. There's always a reason for it. And it took her years of on her face before God, Lord, what was the sin? Why did my daughter, this daughter, not the other children, why did this daughter have this eczema? There's got to be some reason. And she found out what it was. She repented. And then she found this man of faith, and she said, I don't want her just to be healed. I want the Lord to give her a brand new coat of skin, no scars. I don't want to have to, you know, beautiful young girl to grow up covered with scars. And guess what? She got a brand new coat of skin because Jesus said, whatever you ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. You know, once the curse is removed, once the cause is removed for the sin, then we can come boldly and ask. But, you know, we don't receive it just by wishful thinking. And it also says in Job 22:28, and as we become joint heirs with Christ, we become kings and priests, it says in Revelation chapter 1, verse 6. It says, thou shalt decree a thing, and it shall be established unto thee, and the light shall shine upon thy ways. So we have the privilege of finding the Word of God and decreeing it, and then the Lord will perform it in his time. He doesn't guarantee it's going to be instant. We have need of patience that we may inherit the promises. So sometimes his time frame and our time frame may not be the same thing, but the guarantee is there, and that's what's so awesome. And then we can stand on his word, which will always happen. Now, I have to put a caveat in here. In James chapter 4, verse 3. Let me find that. James 4, verse 3. I don't have that in my memory yet. Help me, Jesus. James 4, 3. Or do I? We're not supposed to ask according to our own lust is sort of the bottom line there. 4, 3. I think that's the one. Oh, if we ask for something and we don't get it, it says you ask and receive not, because you ask amiss that you may consume it upon your lusts. So we have to ask according to the will of God. And one of the things people who struggle with is, well, is it God's will to heal, for example? And there's several places that talk about when the when the leper came to Jesus and said, you know, Lord, you can make me clean. He said, I will. And he stretched out his hand and touched him. He touched the untouchable, and he was healed. Because it's his will to heal, and he makes it more abundantly clear in 1 Timothy 2:4, including verse 4. 1 Timothy 2, it says, going back a verse, verse 3, it talks about God our Savior. Of course, Jesus is God and the Savior, who will have all men to be saved. I'll talk about that word saved in just a minute. Who will have all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. So God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved, to be sozo, and come to the knowledge of the truth. The Greek word for saved there is sozo, and it means five different things. Yes, going to heaven. Thank you, Jesus. And thank God for the privilege of going to heaven. We don't want to go to the other place. I don't think anybody in their right mind would want to go to the other place. And the other place is real. So we get to be saved, healed, delivered, preserved, and made whole. It means five things: saved, healed, delivered, preserved, and made whole. And it's in the New Testament about, I don't know, more than 100 times. And it's in there in Acts 16:31, I think it is. It says, believe in the Lord Jesus and you'll be saved, you'll be sozo and your household. Saved, healed, delivered, preserved, and made whole. And it's in the scripture most people use for salvation in Romans 10:9 or whatever it is. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart, that's why Pete has those scriptures about believing in your heart, not just your head, that God has raised him from the dead. It says you'll be saved. You'll be sozo. You'll be saved, healed, delivered, preserved, and made whole. So that's God's will. And then we can ask according to his will, and we can ask nothing wavering, and we get to thank him for it. And it says in 1 John 5:14, these scriptures are so helpful because we need to know that we know that it's his will. And then we don't have to be wondering about it because we have to be in faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God, right? So we want to be in faith. So 1 John 5:14-15. Okay, and this is the confidence that we have in him, in Father God, and in the Word of God, in Jesus, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. And if we know that he hear us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions we desired of him. And some people said that, well, you know, it's God's will sometimes to do this, but not all the time. Because, you know, why are there so many people, especially Christians, that are not healed? Well, because, you know, it says, my people perish for lack of knowledge. And that's where I was for decades. And I'm learning. I don't say I've got it all figured out. But I'm so grateful for the folks down at Pleasant Valley Church in Thomaston, Georgia, the Be In Health group. I'm very grateful for the insights that they have. They're not perfect, but they sure helped a lot of thousands and thousands of people to get delivered and healed of all kinds of stuff. And then it says in 2 Corinthians 1:20, this is just to confirm that God isn't wishy-washy. 2 Corinthians, the beginning of 2 Corinthians 1:20. I'll go back a verse. For the Son of God, Jesus Christ, who was preached among you by us, even by me and Silvanus and Timotheus, was not yea and nay, but in him was yea, or yes. For all the promises of God in him are yea, or yes, and in him amen unto the glory of God by us. He wants to work through us, just like he worked through Moses, part of the Red Sea, because he gave us dominion on the earth. And there's a lot of other scriptures. There's a scripture here. I guess I should read some of it. Back in Genesis 9, and I don't want to take all night here, but help me, Jesus. Remember, we're all descended from Noah, if we're human beings, okay? Because everybody else was wiped out. And Genesis 9 is talking about what he gave to us. And it says, starting verse 2, and the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth. That's visible or invisible beast, by the way. And upon every fowl of the air, the spirits in the second heavens, and upon all that moveth upon the earth, and upon all the fishes of the sea, all those different yucky puckies in the sea. And into your hand are they delivered. Yes, yes, the whales and the fish and all that, people like to go fishing, but there's some other stuff in the sea that we may not see with our naked eyes, our natural eyes, I put it that way. So he gave us dominion on the earth. And by the way, verse 6 in that chapter is very powerful, and it's worth pondering probably for days. Just read it. Whoso sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed, for in the image of God made he man. There's something very important about the blood there. Something very important about the blood. And I don't say I've fully understood it yet, but we're getting there, aren't we? And then in verse 11, I will establish my covenant with you. Neither shall all flesh be cut off anymore by the waters of a flood, neither shall there anymore be a flood to destroy the earth. And God said, this is the token. Here's this word token. This, the first and last, it has another letter in the middle in Hebrew, but the first and last letters are the same letters as the word I am, the eternal God. That's his eternal name. That's the name of the Father. Jesus came in the name of the Father. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. That's what people have to say before he returns the second time, particularly those in authority in Jerusalem. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Baruch haba b'shem Yahweh. And it's not Adonai there, it's Yahweh. But blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. Most of our Jewish, Messianic Jewish brothers say Adonai, which is because they don't like to use the name of whatever, however you pronounce it, YHWH. I don't know the Hebrew letters that perfectly, but anyway. And God said, this is the token of the covenant I will make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for perpetual generations. I do set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be for a token of a covenant between me and the earth. Oh, by the way, this is important, verse 14, and it shall come to pass when I bring a cloud over the earth, that the bow shall be seen in the cloud. You do know that there are other spirits that bring clouds on the earth, and we don't see a bow? Just a point of reference, and, you know, something to think about. That's why Jesus spoke to the storm. He would not go against something his Father sent, obviously. He's one with the Father. But he rebuked the storm. He wouldn't rebuke his Heavenly Father, and it was calm. He said, shalom, peace to the storm, and the storm ceased. So sometimes there are storms, physical storms, that actually show up, but we can speak to them in the name of Jesus. And when we're bold as a lion, you can do that. And I did that with my mother, and I've done that a few times, but I was stunned to actually find out that when you're in peace, and it says the God of peace in Romans 16:20, the God of peace will bruise Satan under your feet shortly, and he made peace by the blood of his cross. We have to be in peace, not anxious. But when you speak in peace to the storm, shalom, and then it manifests and it stops, the hail stops and the terrible winds that are pushing rain through locked, closed windows stops instantly and the sun comes out right away. Might could be, as some of my southern friends would say, might could be, maybe Father God didn't send that one. Because that's what Jesus expects us to do. And then we get to see that we can intercede and the Lord will protect us. And I believe one other thing I mentioned with Pat earlier today was that when you do intercede, it's good to cancel. A couple in the Lord who had been attacked by the enemy found out they have to take authority and bind those spirits of retaliation that come against them when they're doing the Lord's work and cancel their assignments in Jesus' name. Speak it out of your mouth out loud. So we cancel all spirits of retaliation coming against me and my family, Pat Holliday and her family, and every member of the body of Christ that's listening in Jesus' name. We cancel those assignments in Jesus' name. Command you to not manifest and go into a cage, and we put gags in your mouth. You may not communicate with us in Jesus' name. And then the Lord will protect us. His blood protects us. That's the faith. The faith is in the blood of the Lamb. That's what will protect us. Amen? Is that you, Pat? I thought I heard someone. Praise the Lord. But he's so awesome. And every now and then, the little church I'm in, our 84-year-old pastor, and he, every once in a while he says, you know, the Lord has been chasing me. He said, I need to pray big prayers. he said, it's not me that's doing the work. It's all about Jesus. It's all about him. And, you know, I mean, obviously, you know, Pat and I can't heal, as Henry Wright says in the church down in Georgia, he says, I can't heal a fly with a toothache. And that's true. But guess what? Jesus already paid the price for our complete healing. So we can pray in confidence. And when all the sins are repented of and we cast out the spirits of infirmity and those things that make people sick, then we can be confident that when we're standing on the Word of God, that he's going to perform his Word. And we would hope he would hasten to perform it, but in his time, he'll do it. And because it's for his glory. It's not for ours, for Pat's, or for Henry Wright's, or Thurman Scribner's, any of these people that have been used of the Lord, but they're just his servants for Jesus' sake. And they're learning too. And I mean, I shouldn't presume that, but I have a feeling Pat's probably knows something more about the Lord this year than she did last year. And I think that's the way it is for all of us, that we're all growing in the knowledge and love of the Lord over time. And that's what I think it's all about. He just wants to walk with each of us in the cool of the day and says, I've loved you with an everlasting love. I have plans for your peace and not for evil. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Together with God, nothing shall be impossible. He that is in you is greater than he that is in the world. And we thank you, Lord, for wanting to dwell in these temples of the Holy Spirit. And when we realize we're not our own anymore, we're bought with a price, we're redeemed, not with corruptible things as silver and gold, but the incorruptible blood as the Lamb without spot or blemish, then it's so amazing that the Creator of the galaxies would want to have relationship with the ones he's created. And there's so many people that are, how do I put this politely? I struggle with this too. There's a scripture I think it's in the beginning of Romans 10. Is that where it is, Lord? Yeah. I have to credit Pete to this. Because he came out of the Roman Catholic tradition many, many decades ago, but he came out of that and many friends in that. And there are believers in the Catholic Church. I'm sure there's some. Where is this one here, Lord? But it's, you know, I've talked to many, and not as many as I probably should, but they believe it's faith and works. And there's some truth to that, but the works follow. They're not required. They follow. It's the cart and the horse thing. And a lot of people in the Roman Catholic Church have heard works, 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 and the faith, they don't really quite grasp how important the blood is. Some of them, when they have communion, they don't even have the cup, which is, and that's a whole other story. There's so much stuff. I'm going to just read the beginning of Romans 10 and see if that's where it is. I'm pretty sure it's in the first couple of verses. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. Yeah, mine too. For I bear them record that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness, that's who Jesus is. He is Yahweh Tzikeinu, the Lord our righteousness. They, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. That's verse 3 of Romans 10. And that's what our challenge is to submit ourselves unto Jesus, unto the righteousness of God. And there's a wonderful couple of scriptures for our Jewish brothers and us too, because we get to partake of all the scriptures. I just want to read this, remember this here in
Marshall?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you now.
Yeah, I got knocked off of the air. I just got back up.
Were gone for a minute there. I thought I heard something and then no response, so I went on.
That's fine. That's fine.
Hopefully I wasn't knocked off. I don't know.
No, you were on.
Okay.
I just got knocked off. So what I think we need to do now is we need to go into prayer.
Yes.
I've invited people to call in on the chat. for personal prayer, but we need to go into prayer before that for what we've been talking about. And tonight, of course, we're talking about Jesus as the center of corporate prayer.
Amen.
And Marshall, I don't think that you can see the chat room, but people are enjoying your teaching and are saying so up there. And I know,
I was just about to mention something when you came back up, Pat.
Okay.
Can I just recite one or two verses?
Sure,
and I'll be...
sure. Go ahead.
It's about the fact that Jesus is our righteousness. I was reading about in Romans 10:3. About He's our righteousness, and it says in Jeremiah 15:16, this is for all of us, but I think we can point to it for our Jewish brothers, and thy words were found, that's Jesus, thy words were found, and I did eat them, speaking of communion, and thy word was unto me the joy and rejoicing of mine heart, for I am called by thy name, O Lord God of hosts. And then it says several chapters later, also in verse 16, and her name is the Lord our righteousness, which I think it's Jeremiah 33:16, and it's in the female form, the Lord our righteousness, Yahweh Tsikeno. And you go back 10 chapters before that in 23, it's a different verse, I think it's, anyway, but his name is the Lord our righteousness in the masculine, in the Hebrew, because that's his name. He is Yahweh Tsikeno. He's the Lord our righteousness. And when we receive His righteousness, when we put on Jesus Christ, we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. We've repented of all sins. The enemy can't touch us. We're washed in the blood, and then we can be bold and go and pray as the Holy Spirit would inspire us to. So, Father, inspire us to pray the way You want, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, you know, prayer does change things, and just about.
Yeah.
Every big revival that has come in the world, it has had a root of prayer to it, including the early moves in American history where God just seemed to just move all over the country and then the world. I think that people have to have the anointing to want to pray, because a lot of people don't really understand the great things that happen when we come together in corporate prayer. And so you call a prayer meeting, you'll have a half a dozen people there, but if you put on a barbecue chicken or whatever, the whole church packs up. But you see, if only they could see what happens in the spiritual realms when we go to a corporate prayer. Because what's happening is we are actually standing in the anointing and the power of the Lord Jesus, and we're speaking prayers directly before His throne, which the Bible says that He collects our prayers like a sweet-smelling savior. In other words, our words to God, to Him, are very, very precious and important. And so if your God, the one that we serve, is able to do above all that we can even think of, and if our words are very, very precious to Him, He's there listening to us. And the Bible says that when we pray, we're sitting in heavenly places, Ephesians chapter 2, with Christ Jesus. So we are, when we go to prayer now, we are going to be sitting at the throne of Jesus. Think about that, in His presence. And so that means that no devil has any authority or any power to come against what's going on between you and God when you pray. And so the church is in just an absolute terrible position as we talk to you tonight, because of the fact that we're in the last days and there's a great falling away of the saints. Many of them are going to be returning, because Jesus said in Revelation, I will give a call. Come out of her, my people. And he says, my sheep hear my voice, a stranger, they will not follow. So that means that as we place our church, our country, our families, every situation in your life and my life before the throne of grace tonight, God is not only hearing them, but he is in charge of all of the angels in the world, and he's particularly in charge of his angels, which he will send directly from his throne to answer our prayers. So when we start praying, I want you to understand and believe with us in unity of prayer that not only is he listening, but he is responding. And the Bible says one can chase 1,000, two can chase 10. And that means that as a corporate group of people, and this prayer meeting is all over the world tonight. It's just not the few that you see up on the chat room, but it's people tuning in on their phones. They're tuning in on their computers. After we get off the air, they'll continue to be able to hear this show. We've got close to 15,000 people that have listened to our show, and it's growing every week. So we've got a lot of people that are walking in agreement with us, Marshall, tonight as we go to prayer. Now, each one of you have a prayer for your church. And now I'm going to pray generally for the church, and then Marshall will pray for his church and his pastor and elders and members, so that you can join in and be in total agreement for your church, so that you see how to pray for your pastor. You know, pastors need prayer. I mean, elders, I mean, they are just overwhelmed with the powers of darkness that are invading the churches today. So the ones that learn and the ones that know, we are the ones that have to stand before the throne and make sure that the gates of hell cannot prevail against the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. So I'll begin, and then I'll turn it to you, Marshall, and you pray under the anointing as to how God is telling you to respond, and all of us are going to be walking in agreement with you when you pray, and they're walking in agreement with me as I pray. So, Father, we just come before your throne tonight with thanksgiving and praise in our hearts. We thank you, Father, that you said that you knew us even when we were in sin. In other words, you knew us before we ever made a commitment for you. The Word of God says that for we did not choose you, you chose us from the foundations of the world. And that means, God, that we are important to you. That means that you listen to us when we pray. That means that we need to cry out tonight for the church and our nation. Our nation, God, has fallen under socialism and progressive Democrats and people that have no morality, that treat their bodies like they're animals. And Father God, the foundation of the marriage has fallen to the ground over our nation because of the leadership has no regard for your institution of marriage. The churches, God, many of them have fallen in step with the powers of the world. And they are, many of them, just receiving whatever they say. If they want homosexual marriages, that's what they're doing. If they want the occult to come in, that's what they're doing. But God, as the guardians on this earth, as your truth and your church, because you said, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail. And you told Peter, your representative, you told him that you would find your church upon the mystery of you, Jesus Christ, as the foundation. You spoke to Peter and you said, Peter, you're a little rock, but I will find my church on the foundation of the big rock, which is myself, my name. And you will be able, you and the people that follow me, you will be able to do signs and wonders and feat above all that people can even think of or imagine, because I'm backing you up with my spirit and my word. So we thank you, Father, for our church. I thank you for the church that you put me in, the pastors, God. We ask you to give them strength. We ask you that you will stand with them and that you will give them wisdom. We thank you, Father, that you will give them an eye to see the word as you have written it and to express it under the anointing of the Holy Ghost. We give you praise, God, for each of them, for their dedications to the Word of God. We thank you, Father, that you have called them and us for a time such as this. We give you praise, God, that you will alert us and have us standing under your spout of glory at all times, that we will be able to present the Word of God as you have written it and that you had intended it to be. We thank you that you are calling forth souls in our city from the north, east, south, and west. And of course, our church is also on the internet, Miracle Internet Church. And we thank you that you bring people to that church from all over the world. We thank you that we have ministered to China, people from the islands, people from Scotland, England, Canada, all around and about, God, because you anointed our associate pastor to bring that ministry forth. And he really is the founder of that church. And we give you praise for him. And we lift him and his wife up, our associate pastors at our church, and we ask that you give them strength, body, soul, and spirit, and that you see overcome all the powers of the enemy and myself as the head pastor. What the marshal spoke of earlier over our church and the other churches that will be prayed for tonight. And we bind up all of the retaliating spirits and cage them. And nothing shall touch us, God, and our elders as we go forth and our members. We thank you for them, Lord. We praise you for the elders and the members. That you give them a hunger word. That you will give them, Father, a witness. Spirits, I hear them stand with this church for such a time as this, and our members and their families, and we call all of the families into the kingdom of God that's associated with this church. All of the backsliders, God, we call them. Because time is so short. We ask you, God, that you give them dreams of their needs during this time and visions, that you will even give them a supernatural manifestation if they turn their back on Jesus. God, we ask that you turn them every way but loose. But, Father, at the same time, we bind the powers of the devils over their lives, and we ask you, Jesus, that you will ask your Father to send the warring angels to fight in war against the powers of hell that have taken them captive. And, Father God, we give you the glory that all of those devils are bound And the Holy Spirit will go and convict and convince people to return to you in the fullness and hunger of your gospel before it's too late. We give you praise, God, that if there's anyone that's sick in our congregations or in our families, Father, we just lift them up and we give you praise for them. We thank you, God, that you will touch their bodies, that you will deliver them, that you will heal them. But at the same time, God, that they will respect you and that they will yield to your spirit as you touch their bodies. And, Father, so many times in this day and time, we reach out and pray for the sick and you fully recover them. Just to see some of those people never, ever show up for a church service if we're out on the street or return to the church if we've gone to the hospital and prayed for them or prayed for them over the phone. Father, people are cold today, and we ask that you take your big willering fan and that you will blow on those coals, that you will not let them go out, Lord. We praise you that you will water them and give them a hunger for your word. We give you the glory that you will bless our pastors and the members of our church, that you will bless their finances, their jobs, that you will give them spiritual ears and eyes to understand the truth of the word and the teachings that they receive from the pulpit, that you will encourage us to encourage one another. We ask you, Father, that you will bless the marriages in our church and in our city. We ask you, Father, that the other pastors in our city, that you will drive them to their knees and that they will seek you in hunger, and that they will know if they have backslid, if they are teaching a false gospel or another gospel, and that they will humble themselves before your throne, and that they will come to know the great I Am that Marshall has been talking about tonight. We ask you, God, that they will seek earnestly for their faith and for their deliverances, and God, that they will seek for deliverance if they have not received. We give you praise and glory, God, that all things work for the good of those that are called according to your purpose. And we believe on Blog Talk Radio, on this particular radio program, that we are called as prayer intercessors for the body of Christ, as well as our pastors and our churches, and for the backslidden church. We give you praise for Brother Marshall and his family and his wife and his children and his grandson and all from afar. And we thank you, Father, as we join in agreement with him that they all come into the kingdom of God and that he will see the fruition of his prayers as he has prayed for his family. We bind the devils that war against their souls, and we cage every one of them in the name of Jesus, and we forbid them to continue to drive them into the rebellion. We ask you to soften their hearts because you said in your word that you would give our families a heart of flesh, that you would take away the stony hearts. And we pray that for every listener's family tonight in Jesus' name. We ask that you increase our love for one another, our love for you. We confess that we will stand behind our pastors and the leadership of the church as long as they're standing in truth and as long, God, as you have us to stand. Father, we bind up the gossip and the slander behind their backs. And, Father, in the name of Jesus, we forbid the devil, the accuser of the brethren, to divide our church and to come with that slandering spirit and to draw people away. We bind the spirit of Jezebel over our church and Ahab, and we bind the spirits of idolatry in Jesus' name. And Father God, we stand against judging spirits to enter our fellowship. and we bind all of it in Jesus' name, and particularly the dividing spirits. And Father God, we pray your blessings upon the leadership as well as the membership and all of our families in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Brother Marshall.
In agreement, according to Matthew 18:19. Thank you, Lord. We do continue to come boldly and joyfully before your throne of grace, Father God. And we thank you for the wonderful gift of the Lord Jesus Christ. His name is wonderful. And we come before you because of the Lamb of God, because of his blood. And we thank you. It's only because of the blood of the Lamb. And because you said in your word, if two of you on earth agree as touching anything you ask my Father, he will give it them. And Father, you said in your word in Matthew 18:18, and the next couple of verses, verily I say unto Jesus speaking, whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again I say unto you, that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. And in verse 20, for where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. Where we thank you, Lord, we gather by faith in your name, I am that I am. In your name, Lord Jesus, because of the blood of the covenant. And we thank you for laying down your life for us. We thank you. You're the good shepherd. You laid your life down for the sheep. And you said, the life of the flesh, the soul of the flesh is in the blood. And I've given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls. And you said in Isaiah 53, that when you see that, oh, help me, Jesus. Let's look it up. Thank you, Lord. Isaiah 53. This is, the Lord is, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You said, yet it, in Isaiah 53:10, yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. He hath made him to be sick for us, that says, to be more than sick, but sick, yes. And when thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, Lord Jesus, your blood, your soul, is an offering for my sin. And the sin of each one is receiving your blood. Listening on the line tonight, your blood is an offering. You gave your soul in exchange for our soul, your very self. For Christ is our life, like it says in Colossians. So as it is written, Isaiah 53:10, yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. He hath made him sick with our sickness. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege of that divine exchange. Thank you, Father, you made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. For Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For cursed is every man that hangeth on the tree, as it says in Galatians 3:13-14. Thank you, Jesus. You took our cup of cursing, and we receive your cup of blessing. And we thank you for your cup of blessing, Lamb of God. We thank you, Lord of hosts. We thank you, King Jesus, for laying down your life, your soul, in exchange for each one of our souls. We thank you for pouring yourself into us. You said, I'm as water poured forth. And you changed the waters of purification into the wine of the wedding feast. And you want us to be ready for that great wedding feast, the marriage supper of the Lamb. You want us all to have our garments pressed and white and spotless and ready for that day when the trumpet blasts. And we want to be ready. We want everyone in the body of Christ to be ready, including all of our local fellowships and everyone we have any fellowship with, whether it be through Blog Talk Radio or through Miracle Internet Church or the local fellowships, including the church here in Pennsylvania that I've been affiliated with for several years and any church I've ever been affiliated with. Father, I cry out for my brothers and sisters in the Lord and for those that, Father God, have been injured and damaged by spirits that have operated through Christians in church circles, Father God, and have caused them to drift away or even run away from churches because they think, what a bunch of hypocrites, or worse. I mean, I know that terrible things have been done. Forgive us, Father, for against you and you only have we sinned. I take responsibility and I repent for my brothers and sisters that have said they're Christians, and yet, and even as I have said I'm a Christian, and perhaps even as I have missed the mark in the past, Father, some of them have missed the mark in the past and have maybe gone after other things or maybe listened to other voices. Forgive them, Father, for listening to other voices instead of the voice of the Word of God, our Good Shepherd. Thank you that your sheep, Lord Jesus, do hear your voice. You know them and they follow you, and the voice of a stranger they will not heed. Thank you for the privilege of hearing your voice, your word. We can even just open the Bible and hear you speak to us by speaking your word out loud, but we can know by your spirit, because we thank you for that still small voice that Ezekiel heard when he was in the mountain there running from Jezebel. The first, that is, the Jezebel that was in the flesh, that had that spirit operating through her. The spirit that causes, tries to threaten and cause fear. And we know that fear is the opposite of faith, and we don't want that anymore, Father. So we ask you to deliver every member of the body of Christ from all ungodly spirits of fear, because it says, call upon the name of the Lord, and you'll be delivered. And we ask you to deliver us from every bewitching spirit, every deceiving spirit, because, Father God, you tried to point out to us as we come boldly before your throne of grace because of the blood of Jesus. And Jesus said, if two of you on earth agree touching anything else, my Father, he will give it them. We ask you, Father, to deliver us. And you said in your word in Matthew 24, verses 4 and 5, you said, Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, or I am an anointed one, and shall deceive many. And you said in verses 11 and 12 of the same chapter, chapter 24 of Matthew, and many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. O Father, forgive us for allowing our hearts to wax cold. Forgive our brothers and sisters. Forgive us and forgive all those in the body of Christ, Father, for allowing our hearts to wax cold, even as you caution one of the churches in the book of Revelation. They've left their first love. And in verse 23 and 24 of Matthew chapter 24, you said, and if any man, Jesus speaking, if any man shall say unto you, lo, here is Messiah, here is Christ, and there believe it not, for there shall arise false Christs and false prophets shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch as if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. So, Father, we ask, as we come boldly before your throne of grace with the blood of Jesus, with our big brother Jesus, who says, if two of you on earth agree is touching anything else, my Father, he will give it them. So, Father, we ask you to deliver us from these bewitching spirits that would possibly even try to deceive the very elect, Father God. We ask you to deliver us from these bewitching spirits, Father God. And we know that we're in the last times. We know there's a great falling away. We know we see the signs of the season, Father God, that the end is drawing close for Jesus' return. We don't know the day or the hour. We don't even know the season per se. But we do have some indications from your word. And you said in 1 Peter 4:17, and this is a wake-up call for me and for my local fellowship and for every fellowship, you said, the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it begin at us, what shall be the end of them that obey not the gospel of God? Father, you want us to obey the gospel of God. It isn't just sloppy agape anymore. It isn't just once saved, always saved, and you can live any way you want. You can have fornication and lie and steal and be covetous and not spend any time in prayer, and not spend any time hungering and thirsting for righteousness, but hungering and thirsting for something that may not be righteous. So, Father, we ask you to deliver us from every one of these spirits, and deliver me. Deliver me from any haughty spirits, because it says, whatever you accuse somebody else of, you're guilty of yourself, in Romans 2:1, I think it is. So, Father God, I take responsibility for entertaining any spirit of ungodly accusation. You said, judge not before the time. So if I've been judgmental, Father, because I know it says God scorns the scorner, I don't want you to scorn me. I just want you to deliver me and every member of the body of Christ. I hold them up before you. I hold up the pastor, associate pastor at the church I'm affiliated with. You know full well who they are, Father God. And I hold up all those in ministry and all those in any position of authority and everyone who's ever even set foot in that church, Father God, and ever will set foot, and ask you to forgive them, Father, by the blood of Jesus. Jesus said, the things I have done, you will do, and greater things than these. And did Jesus love us and wash us from our sins in his own blood? And does it talk about the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel? And doesn't it talk in, help me, Father, in, I believe it's, is it 2 Peter? No, it's 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 1. It talks about Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. And in verse 2 of 1 Peter chapter 1, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through sanctification of the Spirit. Father, we ask you to sanctify us all by your Holy Spirit. We ask for the fullness of your Holy Spirit. Because it says in Luke 11:13, if you being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them than ask him? Father, we ask for the fullness of the Holy Spirit, a fresh outpouring of your Holy Spirit, Father God, not just for our local fellowship, but everyone who's listening, everyone affiliated, every member of the body of Christ, any of us have anything to do with. And you said, the bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? We're all members of the body of Christ, that one bread. So we pray for every member of the body of Christ, universal, worldwide, Father God. We pray, Father God, in Jesus' name, that you will sanctify us by the Spirit, that you will send the Holy Spirit to guide us into all truth, that you will give, the Holy Spirit will give us every gift that he wants each one of us to have, Father God. We desire to prophesy. We desire to interpret tongues. We desire to do works of miracles and healing and all that you want us to do, the gifts of the word of knowledge, word of wisdom, every gift that you want to give, Father God, that you, Most High God, and you, King Jesus, would be glorified. And we thank you, Father, for sending your word and healing us and delivering us, and that all things hold together, consist in you, Lord Jesus. We ask that you cause the body of Christ and all the members, the families, the husbands and wives, to consist, to hold together, the body of Christ to consist, to hold together. The body of Christ is not divided. You're not coming for, you know, one little group over. You do say you're the good shepherd, Lord Jesus, and you have many flocks, but there will be one fold and one flock. You say, come out from among them and be ye separate. You want us to come out from all the tainted systems, the ones. So, Father God, cause us to hear and do what Jesus wants us to do, to be obedient, to be in fellowship where it's possible, to the degree that is possible, and we ask you to deliver us from every one of these deceiving spirits that you cautioned us about in Matthew 24 and in Mark 13 and in many places. You cautioned us about that. And Father, we ask you to deliver each member of the body of Christ, including those in the fellowship I'm involved with, Father God. We ask for every gift of the Spirit, including the gift of the discerning of spirits, Father God, that will say, gee, that man who professes to be a prophet, everybody says he's such a great man of God. Well, gee, he foretold about this hurricane hitting this southern state in the United States. And, well, he wasn't there praying for the people that were lost their homes and people were killed. He seemed to be gloating about the fact that he got it right. Could it be that maybe he's not true prophet? Does it say the prophets are subject unto the prophets? Does it not say, touch not mine anointed and do my prophets no harm? Well, if he's a true prophet, then may the love of God be shed abroad in his heart, Father God. Send the Holy Ghost to those people that have prophesied these things and have come to pass. But Father, if they're not yours, if they're doing it by some other spirit, we ask you to deliver those men and deliver those who were followers of them, who have not noticed the little bushy tail sticking out of the sheep's clothing that they've slipped into, that have not noticed the fangs hanging out of their cute little sheep mouths, Father God. Help them to have the gift of discernment, Father, and change those men's hearts, Father. You say, pray for those who despitefully use you. Father God, we don't wish ill on them. We ask you to deliver them. We ask you to forgive them by the blood of Jesus. I plead the blood of Jesus over all those false prophets, whoever they are. I don't even know who they are, but you do. You know each person's heart, Father. You know whether they're doing it because they've been bewitched or whether they're doing it intentionally. Or maybe they're just not as sanctified as we would all like to be, because I haven't fully arrived either, Father. And if I'm accusing somebody else, I repent for myself, Father. Forgive me, Father, but we need to be aware, Father. So help all of us to have every gift that you want by your Holy Spirit, including the gift of discernment. Help us to see the little bushy tail sticking out, the little fox's tail, the wolf's tail sticking out of the sheep's clothing. Help us to notice the fangs, Father God, if somebody's breathing out terrible things, Father God. Help us to see the telltale signs, Father God, and pray for them and not fellowship with them until they actually come into the body of Christ and actually show the works that say you know them by their fruit. You said a thorn bush doesn't produce olives and things like that. Help them to produce good fruit, Father God. Help us all to produce good fruit for you, Father God. Change us all from glory to glory as we behold your glory with open face, and help us to do that. Help us to behold the glory of the Lord with open face. Not as a little child, yes, as a little child, say, wow, the creator of heaven and earth came in the flesh, and he bled and died for me. Wow, he loves me. Oh, he wants me to love my neighbor as myself. So, Father, help us to do that. We pray for all those that have despitefully used us in any way, those that are given to just using Christianity as a way to get rich quick or send your money into my ministry because we're going off the air if you don't support us this week. Or, Father God, we ask you to forgive those that have used the ways of the world, the spirit of the world, to try and do things that may or may not be pleasing in your sight, Father God. Help them and help all of us to do all that's pleasing in your sight, Father, because we know that you said, my sheep hear my voice. I know them when they follow me. You said, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Everyone who's doing your will, you'll provide for them, Lord, because you said you would, because you're our good shepherd. And you provided the Lamb of God. He withheld not his own son, Father. How shall he not also with him freely give us all things, everything each member of the body of Christ needs? So help us to be attentive. And if you say for us to give, help us to give. And if you tell us give elsewhere, then help us to give elsewhere, to do what you want, Father. But, Father, we ask that you give us the fullness of your Spirit, Father God, as members of the body of Christ, because you said Jesus was anointed without measure. And you said he spoke as a man of authority, not just as one of the scribes. So help us to speak as of authority against the demons, Father. So we bind every one of these deceiving spirits, because you said whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. We turn to the accuser of the brethren, Satan, we command you in Jesus' name because of the blood of the covenant to cease and desist coming against all of our local fellowships, particularly the local fellowship here in Pennsylvania and all those I've ever had fellowship with and ever will have fellowship with. I command you to remove every lying and deceiving spirit now, for now is the day of salvation in Jesus' name. I command you to remove every one of these bewitching spirits now. I command you to no longer blind the minds of them from receiving the glorious light of the fullness of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I command every bewitching spirit of idolatry to be bound and be thrust into a cage. Every spirit of idolatry of man, every spirit of idolatry of any particular man, a supposedly anointed man of God, every foul spirit of idolatry be thrust in a cage, coming against not just our local fellowship, but every member of the body of Christ, including those that have gone into certain sects of the Christian denominations, Father God, that actually think it's okay to pray to statues and pray and think our statue, Mary, has more power than your statue, Mary. Father God, deliver those in Roman Catholicism from spirits of idolatry, Father God, those that have a heart for the real Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Father God, deliver them, Father God. We ask you to write your law in their hearts, Father God. We ask you to deliver them from the wiles of the enemy, Father God. Deliver them, Father God, in Jesus' name. Every one of you foul spirits, every all ungodly spirits of religion, we bind you, we command you all to be thrust in the cage, you put gags in every one of your mouths. Every ungodly spirit coming against the body of Christ, local and universal across the all, not just the United States of America, but in the nation of Israel and all around the world, we command every one of you foul spirits to be thrust in the cage, and we lock you in with the key of David. Every spirit, in Jesus' name, that would keep people from recognizing the true Lord Jesus Christ, because they spent so much time looking at cute little drawings and pictures, even pictures of the Last Supper, which may or may not be inspired by the Holy Spirit, because Jesus is not into idolatry. Father God is definitely not into idolatry. We command every spirit of idolatry to not manifest and be thrust in a cage and not manifest for everyone whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life at the end of time, in Jesus' name. And we say, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, to all those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life at the end of time, come forth out of them. Come forth out of all ungodly spirits. Come forth out of all those, every one of you foul spirits, have nothing further to do with them anymore. In Jesus' name, as I'm seated in Christ Jesus in the heavenlies at the right hand of the Father, Father, in your presence is fullness of joy. And the joy of the Lord is our strength. And the God of peace shall bruise Satan under our feet shortly, as it is written. And we thank you for your evident token. We thank you, Father God, and nothing terrified by your adversaries, which is to them an evident token of perdition or destruction, but to you of salvation, and that of God. Father, we ask that you send reinforcing angels, guardian angels, warring angels, including the angel of the Lord that encampeth round about them that fears him and delivers them. We ask you to deliver every member of the body of Christ, not just our local fellowships, but all across this country and all around the world. And Father, we do pray for the peace of Jerusalem, Father. We pray for our brothers and sisters, because Jesus came first to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Father, you said at the end of the age of the time of the Gentiles is fulfilled, that their hearts would turn to their Messiah, that they would recognize their brother in the flesh that was slain. Father, we ask you to deliver them, to bring proper conviction, Father God, but to know that it was not they alone, but it was Satan who worked through people, Jew and Gentile alike, who caused the crucifixion of Jesus. But quite frankly, he could not have even touched Jesus, because Jesus had power to lay down his life and power to take it up again. And as we have communion, we're partaking of the very life of the Son of God, his soul, his blood, Christ in us, the hope of glory. We thank you, Jesus, for taking up your life again in your body. We thank you, Lord, for ruling and reigning in the true body of Christ. We thank you for not leaving us as orphans, Father. We thank you for the spirit of adoption. We thank you, Father God, for loving us perfectly. We thank you for your perfect love that casts out all fear. We thank you for your love, your perfect love that covers a multitude of sins, that love expressed by the blood of God shed abroad, washing us in his own blood. Thank you, Jesus, for loving us and washing us from our sins in your blood. And we thank you, Father, for hearing our prayers and petitions and declarations and making them effectual and fervent. For you said the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man will avail us much. We thank you for the gift of righteousness, Father God, for Jesus Christ of Nazareth is our righteousness. All our righteous deeds are as filthy rags compared to what he did. It's all about Jesus and all about his blood. We love you, Lord Jesus, and we thank you. We thank you for purchasing us with your blood. And we thank you, Father, for hearing our prayers and petitions. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are in heaven now making intercession for us, even right now, as is written in Hebrews 9:24. We thank you for making intercession for us. We thank you that Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us because of the blood of your covenant. And we thank you for honoring your blood of your covenant. We thank you for honoring your word. And we thank you for hearing our prayers and delivering those at the churches I've been affiliated with, particularly the one I'm affiliated with now, from these deceiving spirits. And we thank you, Father, for hearing our prayers. We ask you to send the Holy Ghost to all those who have been misleading the members of the body of Christ, those who you can change their hearts, Father, because the heart of the king is in the hand of the Lord, and you turn in whichever way you will as the rivers of water. It's not too hard for you. You can raise one up and put another down. So, Father, we ask you to change the hearts of those who have been deceiving the members of the body of Christ, whether willingly or unwittingly, I don't know. But you know. We ask you to change their hearts, Father God. And if their hearts are unwilling to be changed, Father God, we ask you, Father, to replace them with men who have hearts for you and the Lord Jesus the way you want, Father God, in Jesus' name. And we thank you for doing so according to your promise in Matthew 18:19, in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 We just give God the glory and the power.
Amen.
You know, it's just so wonderful to know Jesus personally, that you can just go and speak to him like a friend, like you just did. I mean, and the greatest thing about it, of course, is that he's listening to us, and he loves to hear his people pray and intercede, and You know, that's what turned the world upside down for Christ in the book of Acts. When they got in jail for preaching the gospel, the church came together and they interceded. And while they were praying, God delivered Peter. And he came and knocked at the door of the church, and the woman came and she said, "It looks like Peter." And so God is able to respond instantly to everything and every prayer that we do. And we just give him glory and praise.
Thank you, Lord.
He loved us and he loves us and he loves all of the people that are praying with us and listening to this broadcast tonight. You know, Marshall, we have seen some astounding things happen since we opened up our lines on Blog Talk Radio, and we give God the glory for it. We saw a young lady delivered last Wednesday from an abuse where her father had abused her as a child. And over the years, as I've prayed for people in those kind of situations, and I've prayed for both men and women that grew up in those demonic things. Whenever they grow up, they're stilted, their spirit of Asmodeus and incest spirits rule over them, and fear and doubt and unbelief and terror and nightmares and all kinds of wicked things. And what happens is these people are terrorized for the rest of their life because of an earthly father is the closest thing that they have that they're supposed to be secure with. And so when these things happen, you have to immediately drive those tormenting spirits out. You have to lead that person in forgiveness toward those people that have done that to them. And at the same time, you also have to turn them to Jesus and his word so that they can, their minds and their spirits can get refilled with the good things. And you see, they've had an earthly father that molested them. They have to know that God, our Father, is holy and pure, and that whenever we go to him, he turns all of those wretched things around that these devils have done to them through earthly connections. So a lot of times I've noticed up on Blog Talk Radio, a lot of people wait until the last 5 or 10 minutes and then they get enough courage to call. We're at 805-292-0300. And Brother Marshall and myself and the people up on the Blog Talk and chat room and all over the world are here to pray for you. And so don't let this skip by you. Don't let the devil whisper in your ear, "Oh, well, you know, if you go up there, so-and-so might even recognize your voice." And you don't want to demean yourself like that. You're not demeaning yourself. When you come up and you get on our microphones, you with us are standing right before the throne of God. And he's looking at you. He knows your real name. We might not know, and we don't care who you are. All we care about is making that divine protection between you and your Father. So we're inviting you now, come on up, make yourself known, put your hand up by dialing 1 when you dial 805-292-0300, and you press 1. And then we see this little yellow hand go up, and we listen to you, and then we cry out for God for you. But we're not the only ones praying for you, are we, Brother Marshall?
No. Many people listening. Thank you, Lord. Thank you
for
the hearts of the Lord.
Yeah. And they're concerned. They're just as concerned about you. And then even when we get off of the air, people continue to pray, you know. And we give God the glory and the praise. While we've seen people raised up off of their deathbeds on this radio program since we started it, we've seen crippled people after deliverance get out of their beds and walk across the run across the room shouting and praising God, because you see, it's a divine connection between that person and Jesus. And whenever they cry out to Jesus, then he reaches out right then instantly, and he's able to touch them. Brother Marshall, what would you say would be the biggest miracle that you've seen in your ministry?
Hmm. You mean something personally or other people?
Yeah, something personal.
Well, let's see. I guess when my family and I went down to Pleasant Valley Church in Thomaston, Georgia, which is the ministry that's associated with Be In Health. If you look online, it's beinhealth.com. But we went down there 9 years ago, and our older daughter had been sick for 5 years. And I'd heard, you know, there's power in testimonies. Because there was a woman at a health food store. She said one of her coworkers, who was a good Catholic young lady who wanted to be a nun, but she'd had the same thing my daughter had. She was allergic to everything, practically everything. And she went to that ministry, and she was ministered to, and she was healed. And this lady said, well, if she was healed, and your daughter's got the same thing, and by the way, there have been thousands of people with allergies, all kinds of terrible, that have been healed. They have great insights. I'm quite convinced, as long as you're not bothered by the Christian doctrine, or you're not bothered by modern medicine, because they use both there, and not they don't give people pills or anything. I mean, they use the insights from modern medicine. They glean from medical research to see the spirits that are behind them. And she said, I'm sure your daughter will be healed. And I read the book, A More Excellent Way, and we went down there, and she was healed in 3 days of what she'd had for 5 years. And that was just the beginning, because then I was healed of many things. I don't know whether it was 12 or whatever it was, and our marriage was put back together, because we'd been seeing a Christian, so-called Christian marriage counselor for 2 years every week for a big chunk of money. You know, it added up after every, you know, 52 weeks in a year. It adds up. $90 a week. And going down to Georgia was practically free by comparison. It's not free, but it's practically free. It's free that it's cheaper than all the time I spent going to doctor's offices and getting antibiotics for the frequent sinus infections I used to get and all of that. But praise the Lord. So Sarah was healed. Our daughter was healed in 3 days, and that was 9 years ago, and it's not returned. She's had other challenges in her life, but that the allergy thing did not come back. And she had her worst reaction the day we showed up there. And that's when I found out these spirits they're talking about, they're real. And that's what sin is. Sin is a disembodied spirit, like a spirit of fear. God has not given us the spirit of fear. But we can entertain it or not entertain it. We have a choice. You know, whose report will you believe? You know,
that's right.
We have a choice. Is God really bigger than the boogeyman? Yes, he is. Is the arm of the Lord not too short to save? Last I heard, he's got a really long arm. It reaches all the way from the third heaven all the way down here. So, he healed me of I was taking thyroid medicine for 30 years. I got to repent. The spirits were commanded to leave, and guess what? I didn't need the medicine. I used to have terrible sciatic pain running down my right leg. It all went away that same week. I used to have what was called GERD, esophageal reflux. I used to have to take Pepcid or Tums or Mylanta or something for indigestion. Had to be so careful about what I ate, and I couldn't eat just before going to bed and all the rest of it, because I would get into – and I knew, because I saw the results. Now, whose report are you going to believe? I saw the barium swallow at the hospital. I saw it go down and come halfway back up my esophagus. And I'm trained in the medical field, so I said, gee, I saw it with my own eyes. But at the end of that week, guess what? It's been 9+ years, and I've only had the equivalent of 2 tums in all of that time. I used to take something like that every day.
Wow.
So they have wonderful insights, and then little miracles that I've seen. There was a reason God did it this way, but I prayed with my older daughter. She lost her expensive sunglasses, and she didn't want to have to go buy new ones. And so we stood on Matthew 18:19. We were in agreement. We asked the Father in Jesus' name to restore her sunglasses. Well, a week went by. She's just thanking the Lord, and then she showed a week before she found them, well, before they were returned, however you want to put it, she showed her mother the empty sunglass case and said, I'm going to put this in my car so when my sunglasses are returned, I'll know where the case is. I don't want to lose that too. And mm-hmm. So a week after that, 3 weeks after we prayed the original prayer, and I wasn't thanking the Father every day. Some people say that's a good thing to do. Once you ask, keep saying, thank you, Father. And he likes it, just like a natural parent would like. You know, I'm sure you had children and you gave them a wonderful dessert or something. But thanks, Mom, that was really good, right? You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
we like that. We like to have things. We really appreciate that. Well, our Heavenly Father is the same. He really appreciates it when we appreciate what he does for us. So anyway, but she didn't get into unbelief. She didn't get, I thought it was going to work. Or it's been 2 weeks and I haven't found them yet. I guess I'll never. She didn't open the door to the enemy that way. Because if you say, I thought it would have, or I guess it's not for me, or it must only be for other people, if you don't go there, you don't give the enemy legal right, because death in life is in the power of the tongue. Well, anyway, at the end of the 3 weeks, she went into her car on a hot summer day, and she just bought a cheap pair of replacement sunglasses because it was really bright out, and she said it didn't fit in the case that she got them, and she's just going to put them in the other case for the ones that she was missing, and here's a locked car. Nobody had access to it but herself. She opens up the case, and there are the sunglasses.
Wow.
Now, how the Lord put them there, that's between him and the angels or whatever. I don't know how he put them in a locked car, in a sunglass case that she left that was empty, that she showed her mother the empty case the week before, and she sat there with her mouth looking like a little goldfish, you know,
See,
God is bigger than our problems. And that was a small example, but it was a miracle all the same as far as I'm concerned, because it was not normal to have something just appear in a locked car that nobody put there. And really nobody did, and I know my daughter's not lying.
Right.
And she got them back, and God honored his word, but he was trying to get her attention because she was just starting. You prayed that God would do something supernatural to keep people from drifting away. Well, that's partly what he was doing. He was trying to get her attention. Now, who do you want to follow? Which spirit do you want to follow, the Holy Spirit or one of these other spirits?
Yes.
So he was trying to get her attention because she lives in the world like we all do, and there are things in the world that can entice us and want to pull us away just a little bit. Well, God wouldn't mind if I just did a little of this because he's so merciful and loving.
Mm-hmm.
But he wants to get our attention to say, don't you want me to answer your prayers? Don't you know I really love you? And he does. He loves each one of us. And we've all missed the mark somewhere along the line, but we get the wonderful opportunity to avail ourselves of 1 John 1:9. And then we get to be back in fellowship, washed in the blood, and then we can come hop up in Daddy's lap and say, Daddy, I can't find my sunglasses.
Yeah.
And he is so wonderful. And then I get to be 500-plus miles away, and my wife says, my mother-in-law tell you that her freezer was making funny noises before you left on your trip? Well, yes. Well, then it's your responsibility. You make sure she gets a new freezer on this holiday weekend with her freezer full of frozen food and the thing just stopped working. Well, how was I going to – my arm isn't that long. I mean, yes, I use the phone. But I also got on my face before the Lord and I said, Lord, I need some help here. And I asked the Father, and I called a bunch of places. Yes, I had to do something too, but he managed to have somebody who was willing to actually deliver a new freezer, take out the old one, and she got a freezer on a holiday weekend when nobody was working. That was an answer from the Lord, you know.
Amen.
I've seen some things, and I'm very grateful.
Yes.
And there was one quickie, little one. A lady lost her keys, a good friend of ours. She's a believer. And she'd looked for them for hours, and she called me and said, I can't find my keys. Her husband had been over the day before helping me with something with her little children there. And he'd given the keys to one of the children, to Zaki, and she couldn't find the keys. And they had the keys for her car and her house and her business. And so James chapter 1 says, if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth all men liberally and abradeth not, and it will be given him. I don't know if I knew that part of the verse. And it will be given him, but we ask that way. And he gave me this like Polaroid image in my head of, I saw the grass, I saw this path outside, I saw keys in the grass right after we prayed. And I have not had that before or since. I don't usually, in the past anyway, but he can do what he wants. He's God. But I asked, he gave me, and he said, I'll call you right back. And I ran outside, and there were the keys right where he showed me where they were. So he answers prayer, and he's real, and he loves us, and Jesus is resurrected from the dead, and he is alive, and he is with us, and he's awesome. He really is awesome. But there's so many people that would really benefit from getting to know him a little bit better, because he just wants to walk with each of us. He wants to walk with me more intimately. I need to spend more time with him. I spend some time, but there's always the opportunity to get to know him better. It's like a husband and a wife getting to know one another. You know, when you first met your proposed spouse before you're married, you spent some time with him, but then after you got married, you maybe spent a little bit more time, and maybe after you've been married for 10 years, you knew him a little bit better than you did the first week after you were married, and then maybe after 30 years, you knew him a little bit better. And that's what it's like with our walk with the Lord. We get to know our beloved. He is our beloved.
Yes.
We are his.
Yes. Well, you know, Marshall, you and I talked a little bit today, not long, but I mentioned to you about the Red Shield. And this
right.
is corporate prayer night where we can pray for our countries and our church. And, of course, we have to pray concerning the world situation, because it's affecting our nation now so starkly. The gases have gone so high that many can hardly get back and forth to work. People are losing their homes. People have lost their everything. They no longer really, some of them, have anything to leave to their sons and their daughters. And, you know, Gorbachev, when he came to the nation, I think it was back in the 60s, he pounded his shoe on the United Nations table. And my husband gave me the interpretation, because he was from Russia when he was alive. He said, your grandchildren shall be communist. And you know, that's what's happening to us right as we are here on this radio today. Our nation is turning toward that spirit very quickly, and it's a world move. It's being moved by a little clique of men and women that have taken over the banking systems of the world, and at the top of that banking system is a family called Rothschild. And I mentioned to you that that is the family that is the top of the witchcraft families of the world, called the Illuminati, that they own 48% of the world's gold, and they are head of the Federal Reserve Bank here in America. And there's about six banks that are taking over the world as I'm speaking to you. And our Congress and our Senate are cowered and have joined forces with them instead of the Constitution. And our nation is just rocking and reeling. We're in terrible, terrible, terrible danger, more than ever before in my life. And one day I was praying about these things, and the Lord spoke to me, and he said, break the red shield. And I said, what are you talking about, the red shield? And he said, well, you know the Star of David. You know that 300 years ago, the Rothschilds I said Rockefellers earlier. I'm talking about the Rothschild family, excuse me, in London.
I think you said it the way you intended to. I think you said it the way you intended, yes.
Okay. Well, anyway, what happened was 300 years ago, the head person that created the banking system by the name of David Anshaw Rothschild took a star, a six-pointed star, and he hung it on his gate. And his name was Bauer at the time, and he changed his name from Bauer to Rothschild, which means red shield. And he said, I am the protector of the red shield. Now, if you know anything about witchcraft, the star, the six-pointed star, is one of the most powerful stars or symbolism in witchcraft that is on the earth. All of your high-level Satanists use that particular symbol. For instance, if they come into a Christian fellowship and they see a Christian with that star of David around their neck, that particular Christian is open for that a wizard or that witch or that Satanist to direct powers of that person. And today, many preachers have pushed the Star of David because of a few scriptures in the Bible. However, it was the Rothschild family that put the Star of David on the flag of Israel, which if it was to be for Jews, it should have been a candelabra, you know, one of those seven candlesticks. And so, but anyway, so Christians, many of them want to do what the Bible tells them, and they just listen to some of these people, and they just go about, I did as a baby Christian, and do whatever they tell them to. And you can get in a lot of problems wearing an occult symbol around your neck. You cannot get delivered. If you've got one on your neck, take it off tonight and get rid of it, and you'll find out that God will honor that, and you'll be able to hear more, and you'll be able to do more for God without that hanging around your neck. It's a ball and chain to the Illuminati. So, but anyway, God spoke to me, and he said, break the shield. So we came up on the Blog Talk Radio a couple of weeks ago, and we were praying for our country, and we were praying for the world. And I took authority with the people in agreement with me to break the shield. Now, the other thing is 2012 is their year to bring into being the New World Order. It may not be God's time, but it's their time. So they are calling it the Year of Blood Sacrifices. And so they're having a primary one down in Rio de Janeiro. And the last time they gave us something called Agenda 21, which is why our gas bills are so high, because they're implementing what they did down there 20 years ago right now. So they've gone back down there. Now, the first time that they were down there, they did nature worship. And they went over to the river, and they did sacrifices to the river gods there. And see, American Christians, they just don't believe that there's anything about this. And there is. Because, see, they're doing their sacrifices, but most Christians are just walking around thinking that they're real intellectual because they'll see somebody say something and they just mimic it and put it up on Facebook. And, oh, they think that they're very bright, but they're not. And they don't know spiritual warfare. And so what I'm getting at is this. We broke the shield, and we continue to agree that that shield is broken all over the world. But now we're going to take authority as a group of people, and we're going to bind the blood sacrifices because they need blood sacrifices to bring together the kingdom of the devil. So they're going to have a blood sacrifices out at the Bohemian Club. They've got those kind of clubs scattered all over the world. Each country has its little group of leaders that go in and worship their devils. And the blood sacrifice is a requirement for the devil to be able to bring forth into this realm the things that he's working for. If you remember, when Elijah went up and challenged gods of Baal,
the prophets of Baal.
Yeah, the prophets of Baal. They were chanting, they were cutting themselves to bring blood because there was no sacrifices there for them to shed the blood. They were trying to bring from the spiritual realm into this realm the power of God, but they were not able to because the man of God was there and he was mocking them. He was mocking those devils. Where's your God? Where's your power? And this and that. But when he stood up, he, of course, called down the anointing and the power of God. And you've heard that story where the fire of God came and lapped the water up and so on and so forth. Well, if we'll stand our ground, God will stand the ground that we need to be bound for us. So what we're talking about tonight is world powers. We've prayed about our local churches. We've prayed about our country, our president, the leadership, the people that are running for office in our land. Probably more than 38% of our congressmen and our senators are serving these strange gods as I speak to you. Our country's gone unless God does something for us supernaturally quick and dramatic. And so tonight, what I want to do is in agreement, and everybody on the chat room, just raise your hands in agreement. You know, raise the little smiley hand. And all of you listening in on your radios and at home, just raise your hand in agreement. And let's come into agreement and bind the blood sacrifices. Now, how do we do that? The way that we have always done that is I take authority over the blood sacrifices, and then the Lord told me to put a supernatural tent over the people performing those duties, the priest. And then the Lord told me that when they released the powers to go forth, for us to command their prayers and their powers just to fall back upon them and release his anointing and his power across the world. And I believe that this is a key, Marshall. I really and truly do believe. Everybody's putting their hands up now on the chat room, and I've got my hands up. Everybody listening, have your hands up. And now, Father, we just come into one accord as your church. And, Lord, there are people all over the world that are a part of your church with their hands up in agreement. And we take authority over 2012 and the blood sacrifices that they're doing all over the country in every meeting that they have, whether we call their names out or speak of them or not. Every
country, not just this country. Amen.
Every country. We're praying a world prayer in Jesus' name. And we bind the blood sacrifices. And in the name of Jesus, we release that supernatural intent over each one. And as they release the powers of the devil, that they just fall back upon them. And Father God, they love curses more than blessings. We ask you, Father, that if there's any that are seeking your face that want to get out, that you will get them out But God, in the name of Jesus, we're speaking to the devil's people of the world. We are taking authority over you for the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we command that you will take your hands off of God's people. We command you will take your hands off of the church. We command in the name of Jesus that we release the anointing and the power of God, and we call forth and ask our Lord Jesus to send forth the warring angels worldwide and to bring those souls of the great harvest into the kingdom before our Lord Jesus Christ returns to this wicked world. We give you praise and glory, God. We say that their season of sin is over, and all those sexual devils that they have promoted in our school kids and across our nation and around the world, we command those devils that they can no longer give them pleasure, because between the belly gods and the sex devils and the money, that's all they have. And Father God, you said in the book of James that they shall cast their gold out into the streets, and you said that it would be worthless. And I don't know how you're going to do that. I just know that as your believers, that you're going to protect us no matter what happens or how it happens. We take authority over this Obama nation that sits in our White House. And we ask you, God, he's been uncovered. We ask for an arrest. We take authority over the bankers that have stole the wealth of the nation. And we ask for them to be arrested. We ask you, God, for people that they have stolen our houses and our finances and our money. We cover our finances and our money and our houses as Christians and ask for your divine protection over what you have given us. We take authority over the United Nations, and we bind that New World religious devil in Jesus' name. We bind the killing of babies. We bind up the killing of old people. We bind up taking away the Social Security from old people and their rights to die normally. Father God, people that are receiving Social Security, it is not charity. They worked all of their lives and paid into that system. And Father God, nobody, we forbid anybody to touch the money that they've slaved and worked for in Jesus' name. We give you praise for the pastors, the churches, the members of the churches worldwide. We ask that you shake them, wake them up, the leadership, no matter what area that they're ministering in, and we release the Holy Ghost to go and convict of sin and give a final call to these people in Jesus' name. We give you the praise and the glory. And we break the powers of those blood curses, and they cannot work. That we break all the prayers to the water gods down in Reno and the water gods that they visit in the city under the sea. We are taking authority worldwide tonight with those that are walking in agreement. And our power is greater than theirs, because you said in your word, God, one person in you makes the majority. And we have more than one person in agreement. And you told us to stand as the vanguard, that the gates of hell will not prevail over our church. And we just stand against the powers of darkness tonight. We release your glory. We release every need, every job, everything that anyone that has lifted up their prayer to ask you for this day, that are real, honest-to-God Christians, that you will meet their needs. Marshall, do you have anything to add to that? In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name, I'm in agreement. I thank you, Father, for delivering us. You said, call upon the name of the Lord and you'll be delivered. We ask you to continue to deliver all the Christians and those coming into the body of Christ, Father God, globally, Father God, on this planet. We thank you for creating this wonderful planet. And we command the enemy, anything he's stolen, to restore it sevenfold to every member of the body of Christ. because we have a better covenant founded upon better promises. And when the Israelites came out of Egypt, they came forth, not one feeble one among them, it says in Psalm 105:37, but also it said they came forth with silver and gold. And that speaks of natural riches. So we ask that the natural riches that have been stolen, even as the enemy tried to steal from the Jewish people for 400 years, that it's being restored to the members of the body of Christ in Jesus' name. We command it to be restored sevenfold in a minimum in Jesus' name. And we thank you, Father, for hearing our prayers and our petitions, Father God. And we thank you. We bind every spirit of retaliation. We command them all to be thrust in a cage and locked in with the key of David. We have gags in their mouth. They have nothing further to do with. They may only hear what the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth wants them to hear. And we thank you, Father, for the blood of Jesus as a wall of fire around about us. We thank you for your armor of light, Lord Jesus. You are the light of the world, and in you we live and move and have our being. And we thank you, Lord, for delivering us from the power of darkness and translating us into the kingdom of your beloved Son, that kingdom of light, Father God. And we thank you, Lord Jesus. We look forward to that day when you, Lord Jesus, the Lamb of God, will be the light in the New Jerusalem. We thank you for your light that is shed abroad in our hearts, Father God. We thank you for your love being shed abroad by your Holy Spirit. We thank you, Father God. And we ask that the Lord Jesus baptize every member of the body of Christ afresh with the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Holy fire, Father God. No strange fire, your holy fire, Father God. Your zeal, Father God, that same zeal we were reading about in Isaiah chapter 9, that zeal of the Lord, your zeal in us, Christ in us, the hope of glory. Be glorified, Father God. Be glorified, King Jesus. Thank you for the Holy Ghost, because we know it's not by might, it's not by power, not by human power, it's by your good Spirit. And you say, we weep not, for we behold the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. You are the Lamb of God that was slain, that is now standing, Father. Standing. We thank you for the Lord Jesus, that Lamb of God that now stands, having seven horns and seven eyes, perfect strength and perfect understanding, perfect vision, perfect understanding of all things. That Jesus Christ made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. We thank you that Jesus Christ is our righteousness, is our wisdom, is our strength. We thank you that Jesus Christ is everything that is talking about in Ephesians chapter 6. He is our breastplate of righteousness. He is our shield of faith. He is our helmet of salvation. He is that good news, the gospel shoes of peace, that we can walk in peace. And Father, when we've been speaking about these people, Father God, Father, we ask you, we pray for those who have been despitefully using us, Father God. And if any of them can be delivered from these bewitching spirits, we ask you, even as Pat was saying, deliver them from the bewitching spirits, Father God. Because you did a mighty work in Bishop Kanko, Father God, delivering him from the powers of darkness. You've done a mighty work in many others who've served Satan, very faithfully serving Satan, I might add, many of these. And you've called them out of darkness into your marvelous light. We ask you to call many others, Father God, out of darkness into your marvelous light. Because together with God, nothing shall be impossible. You can do exceeding abundantly more than we ask or imagine, Father God. And we thank you, Father. We ask you to deliver our brothers and sisters that have been thrown in prison around the world, Father God, for their faith, Father God. And we ask you to deliver those that have been earmarked to be eliminated by those serving the dark side, Father God, the Coptic Christians in Egypt. We ask you to deliver the believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, wherever they are, Father God. Deliver your children, Father God. Deliver them supernaturally or naturally, however they need to be delivered, Father God. In spirit, soul, and body, deliver them, Father God, and use them all for your kingdom and your purposes to bring you honor and glory. In Jesus' name, there's at least two of us on earth, and we're in agreement. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Everybody,
you,
raise
Father.
Your hands
as
a prayer of agreement. We
Thank
just
you,
got through praying this
Thank
very
you,
powerful prayer.
Thank you, Lord.
And we
Thank
do
you, Lord,
agree for all of the prayers that were written on the chat room. We do agree and include every one of them into our prayers that we prayed tonight in Jesus' name.
And we
now,
remember,
they're all raising their hands in agreement.
Amen.
And
we go ahead, Pat. I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
No, I just wanted to say, the Lord is reminding me that when Moses and Aaron went before Pharaoh, that Aaron's rod swallowed up the magician's rods. Our God is bigger than that created God, that bigger than the little demons.
You know, the Lord rebuke you, Satan, in Jesus' name. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested that he might destroy the works of the devil. And Jesus,
yes.
Father, I have finished the work thou gavest me to do. It
yes.
is finished in Jesus' name.
Yes.
And he's coming again to rule and to reign. You know, the kingdoms of this world are becoming the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, as it says in Revelation. But that scripture in Isaiah chapter 9, he's going to rule and reign. There's no doubt about it. You know, he's that rock that they talk about in Daniel, the rock that was Nebuchadnezzar heard about that was going to hit the feet of that statue and crush it. You know, the feet, the toes that were mingled of clay, miry clay, and iron. And then the whole statue's coming down, even the head of gold, that whole thing, the whole. But it's being manifest, you know. It's like when the Lord gave the Israelites the promised land, he spoke to Moses and he said, the Lord will fight for you, hold your peace, and go forward. So, Father, help us to hold our peace. That's Jesus Christ of Nazareth. He himself is our peace. And go forward in Jesus' name.
Amen. That was a good word. That was a very good word. And we give God the glory.
Thank
There's
you,
so
Lord.
Much power here tonight.
Thank you, Lord.
We don't have any calls tonight. I guess God just has an urgency for us to pray. But if you have a prayer request and you just type it up there on the chat room, we will pray for it. We've prayed just about for everything we can think of. You know what we didn't pray for is the healing power and miracle power of God to touch everyone that's praying and listening. Tonight, I was going to mention that to you. I've noticed that sometimes people have been prayed for over and over, and they'll say, someday the Lord is going to heal me. And you can pray for them, and you'll say, well, did the Lord? Well, he's going to do it someday. Let's make tonight a mass miracle healing. And everyone that has something wrong in your body, what I want you to do is put your hand right there, and Marshall is going to pray a prayer of healing for all of us that are listening, and we've got about 3 minutes, Marshall. Go for it. My hand is on my body.
Thank you, Lord.
And up for my family.
Yes, Lord. You said in your word, Father God, that we come boldly and joyfully before your throne of grace, and we thank you for the gift of the Lord Jesus. It says in your word, in Psalms, you sent your word and healed them. And it says in your word that healing, that is deliverance, is the children's bread. We've got the Syrophoenician woman. She wasn't even in covenant, but she worshipped you, Lord. And she said, even the dogs eat the crumbs from the master's table. So we thank you. If that woman's daughter was delivered, and she was, the woman's daughter was delivered because you spoke the word and it was done. And that great Italian leader of the centurion said, only speak the word and my servant shall be healed. There's no distance in the spirit. Father, we ask that you send your word and heal us. And for all those who are looking for healing from you, Lord Jesus, because you're the healer, you're the deliverer, we ask you to sozo us all and all of our family members. Save us, heal us, deliver us, preserve us, and make us every whit whole in Jesus' name. And I remit everyone's sins that have a heart to seek and to serve the Lord in Jesus' name. I remit your sins according to the word of God, because Jesus said, the things I have done, you will do, and greater things than these. So, well, only God can do that. I know. It's under the unction of the Holy Spirit. He is God. And Jesus said, receive you the Holy Spirit. And he said, whosoever sins you remit, they remit it unto them, in John chapter 20, starting on verse 21, 22, and 23, and there. So we remit your sins, and the curse causeless shall not come. And every spirit of infirmity, we command you loose. Go where Jesus Christ of Nazareth tells you to go. Rend nothing on the way. Never return. In Jesus' name, be every whit whole. You see, you shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. We're laying hands. We thank you for the anointing. Christ in us. It's not really our hand. It's your hand in our hand. That's sending the healing, that healing power. And it's not by human might. It's by your spirit, Lord. We thank you, Lord. And if I, by the finger of God, cast out devils, know you this, the kingdom of God has come nigh unto you. And the kingdom of God includes righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. So we thank you for your kingdom being manifest in our spirit, souls, and bodies. In Jesus' name. We thank you, Father. We praise you, Lord. And they've said in your word, if two of you on earth agree as touching anything you ask my Father, he will give it. And if somebody's in agreement, then we have it in Jesus' name. Are you in agreement, Pat?
Yes. And we've
Why don't
got
we have it? Praise you, Lord.
30 seconds.
Thank you, Lord.
You continue
thank
to.
You, Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Father,
praise
for sending
you, Lord.
Your word and healing us, sozoing us, Lord, in Jesus' name.
Yes.
And our families. Because you said, believe in the Lord Jesus, and you'll be sozo in your household. And you said also, Lord, in Deuteronomy 30, verse 6, and the Lord thy God will circumcise thine heart and the heart of thy seed to love the Lord thy God with all thine heart and with all thy soul that thou mayest live. We thank you for the gift
yes.
of life. Amen.
Amen.
The
we
gift
are free.
Of eternal
we are
life.
Free. We give you glory and praise.
We give you glory and praise, Lord.
Thank you for such a delightful meeting tonight, Lord.
And we thank you, Lord, for Jesus watching over us. We thank you for your blood, Lord Jesus, the wall of fire around about all of us in the glory of the victory. We thank you for appointing salvation for walls and bulwarks. Lord Jesus, you are our salvation. And in you we live and move and have our being. And we praise and bless you, King Jesus. We love you, Lord. We thank you for loving us first. We thank you for your perfect love that casts out all fear. Thank you, Lord. You overcome the accuser of the brethren by the blood of the Lamb, the word of our
yes.
testimony. We don't care about our lives compared to Jesus Christ. He's our real life. And death has no more dominion over him. Hallelujah. He cannot die again. He's died once and that's it. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And Jesus, you are our life. Thank you, Lord. We praise and bless your holy name, Lord Jesus.
Yes.
Amen and amen and amen.
We praise you, Lord. We give you glory
praise,
and
Father.
Praise. You're wonderful, Lord. We praise you. Let it be heard around the world, the praise for our Lord Jesus.
Praise.
Thank
praise.
You, Jesus. Glory to God.
Praise.
They've all got their hands up.
Praise the Lord.
Praise in the Lord.
Praise.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you. Glory
Hallelujah.
To God.
Hallelujah.
Wonderful, Hallelujah. Wonderful. We expect headline news.
Hallelujah.
A headline news. And it is every day we see a headline news. Every day. What a beast. Hallelujah. Powerful. Very powerful. We give God glory. Lord, we pray for this Canto. And you go where she is and perform those things out quickly, instantly.
Amen.
And every day, say,
deliver him. Deliver him now. Jesus, and now is the day of salvation.
Right back on you, Jesus' name. We give you praise and glory, God, that we will see the glory of the Lord. It's all. Praise and glory that we expect. Pray in the name of the King. Everything will be praiseable. And Lord, the soul collected during this time of trouble. And I hear there's many of them. We give praise and glory. We thank you for the evil, God, for working on to get us on the milk and on the Amazon, on Books of Million and other places. God, the mindful that they need when you come, God, to pray for you. Where I am, first pray. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise unto Yahweh Elohim. Praise you, Yahweh Elohim. Praise you, Most High God. Praise you, Father God. Praise you, Almighty Lord. Praise your holy name. Thank you for sending your good spirit, Father. Thank you for the Holy Ghost, Father God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for baptizing the Holy Ghost and the Holy Fire.
world.
Thank you, Lord. Praise and bless you, Father. Praise and bless you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Wonderful Lord God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Wow,
the Spirit of the Lord
is upon
me because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, to recovering the sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are free, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord, And this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in you. We claim this day for you, Lord Jesus, and every member of your kingdom. Thanks be to God.
You know Jesus Christ is Lord, and He's given a call to you today.
They're saying that
he
we're still on
come
the
and
air,
live into your heart,
that we can continue on Skype.
Only
you
thing
feel
that
like
you
continuing
have to do
just a few more minutes?
Telling you're sorry
you
for your sin.
Just a couple
of ask Him to come and be your personal Savior. He'll come in. He'll be right there. And the wonderful thing about it is this. You'll be there from now until the end of
praise
the world.
The Lord.
And then you'll meet Him face to face.
Well,
and you'll know
Lord,
that this
Lord,
very day that you ask Jesus Christ to be your
Brother
Lord.
Brother Marshall says he'll stay on a few more
would
minutes.
Would you say a prayer with
on
me today?
The Skype thing?
Dear God.
And we'll see what happens.
Sinner.
If
and
you've
I
got some pointed thing that you want to ask
that's why
you
came and died
the
on the cross for me.
I would
and I ask you, oh God, that you
I can
will
tell him what you're asking because I don't think he can see the chat room.
He's
I don't have a computer.
You. Just to ask him to come in now. Yes, there he is. There he is. See, I told you. Don't you feel wonderful now? Don't you feel clean? Don't you feel marvelous? Just because. He died
those people in the cars, just
he's
ask
your
the Lord.
Lord.
Those people on Skype, ask the
he's
Lord.
Today, your Messiah.
To be your
Christ
personal
Jesus,
Savior.
Jesus.
Thank you.
Amen. Brother Marshall, we're on Skype now. We're off of Blog Talk, but we're on the computer part, which is called Skype. And moratorium says your show continues until an hour after the live stream is finished and can be heard on Skype. And you can take also phone calls, and it will be on the podcast later on. So if somebody wants to call and talk to Marshall, he's only going to stay a few minutes.
Well, I have to help my daughter with something, and then I can come back perhaps after a while. But, I promised her that, and I have to honor that. So.
Okay. Well, can he get back on if he hangs up because he can leave?
No,
his...
I could just leave this, put the phone down a second.
Oh, okay. Go and do that. Go and do
is that.
Is that
all right?
Yeah, that'll
praise
be great.
Lord.
Just don't disconnect.
No.
All
and
right.
I just want to read one scripture here before I go, for a minute anyway. I mean, I'll be back.
Okay.
But it says in Isaiah 43:2, the Lord, this is the promise for us, when thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee, and through the rivers they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. I mean, did the Lord deliver Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? They had faith. He was there in the fire with them. They came out without even smelling the smoke. So we know the Lord's going to judge this earth with fire. We know there's going to be a time when it's really super hot. You know, the people will be blaspheming God and about huge hail coming down and all the rest of it. I don't know. You know, we may not be here. We may be here. I don't know. But we know that that's prophesied, and it's as good as done because God's word is for sure. So I just thought it was an awesome promise that we know that we can walk through the fire and not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee, in Isaiah 43:2. So I'll be back in a minute or three or ten or whatever it is.
Okay, God bless.
The Lord bless you all. I'll be back. God bless.
Yes. Hallelujah. You know, God is so sweet and wonderful. all the time. And so what I'm doing is I'm typing and saying, why don't you call a moratorium since this is your idea? Give us a call over here, and while Marshall's gone, you and I'll talk. The telephone number is, they've taken it down, so I don't know what it is, but they blocked the call number off, so I don't know if you can call in or not, moratorium. Call the number and I'll see if it comes up. He's in the host queue. You did? What is the first three letters of your number? Moratorium. Firstly, three letters. Area code. Because there are people still up there. Oh, let me see. Okay. It doesn't show the user's name. It only shows the area code. I believe that, Margit. I believe this was a world changer tonight. I don't know. You can try moratorium if you're in the queue. If you have an area code, I'll go look and see if you might already be sitting there. Just the first three letters. Yeah, we thank God for tonight because God promised that he would give us answers. And I believe these are some answers that he's giving to us that if you don't want to put your area code, there's several people up there, and so I don't know which one you are. And, I mean, 805-732-352-248-831. I've got all those people still hanging on the phone. So I just don't know which one you are in. So we'll just forget about that. And so, God is real and true. If Christians would just get their eyes on the power of Jesus, I mean, he's the one sitting on the throne of the universe, and he's the one that we have a direct connection with, and he's the one that is concerned about souls. And as we seek him for souls and we're willing to take that cue and go and seek the Lord with our whole hearts, I don't see that up here. So, and I don't know how to use the Skype except just to connect into it. So we'll just have to do that next time. But appreciate you. But he's the one that we just have to tie into, and we're the ones that he is looking over. And the devil is going to have his new world order. But you see, what he's actually doing, and we talk in a parable here and cover this whole night's conversation from machines and Illuminati's people and government people from even hearing what we say in the name of Jesus. I don't know how to work that yet, moratorium. And my son is not here in the room. So we'll figure that out, and we'll do that next time, because I know that some of the deliverance ministries are going up on Blog Talk. I haven't been giving my number out to too many people because, you know, they call me all the time. And when I'm on Blog Talk, I don't need them calling me on Skype. So that's why I haven't given it out to a lot of different people. But I'll go look and see if I see anything up there. No. All I see is, no, I don't see anything up there right now. I don't see anything up there. So I just really don't know how to, you know, I'm not mechanical. And so maybe next time we'll do this. But anyway, God has solutions for his church because the Bible says the gates of hell shall not prevail against his church. And so as we are, as we're sitting here talking about the gates of hell, there's just so many people that are able to stand against the powers of the devil in this last day, because right now everything that can be shaken will be shaken. That's what the word says. And so the church itself is being shaken, and all of the phony baloney ministers and people that are hypocrites playing church, you're going to be able to clearly see who's real and who's phony. And don't follow after the phony people. Just stay very close to those that you know are serving Jesus. And then what will happen is God will protect you during these shaky times. And this is very, very shaky times that we're in. You see, when the president signs a bill saying that he can come to your house and send people to arrest you without a warrant and without a judge or a court, and you can just disappear into a dark hole, they can fly you to another country. And they're doing some very dark things in Washington as I speak to you today. Both the Senate, the Congress, and the President. Very, very scary things are happening. What I'm telling you is that you need to prepare, because we're living in peerless times. That's what the Lord called it. And in peerless times, what we have to do as believers, we have to prepare our spirits to be able to stand, to be able to have that Elijah faith that if there's no food, God's going to feed us. If there's no water, he's going to create water. You know, I've seen him do those things when I'm on the foreign mission field. They're already believing God like that. I remember one time I was staying with one of the ministers over there, and Pastor Evelyn, she had to go from one town to the next to get some food out of one of the official's mom's home freezer for the guests that she was having because we were there. And so on the way, the van just started smoking. And it huffing and puffing, and she said, pull the van over to the side of the road. And she got out the van, and she went out into some a jungle-looking type place. And about 5 or 10 minutes later, she came walking back to the van, and she had a gas tank in her hand. And what it was water. And they put the water in the, whatever they call that, I don't know, but she put it in the van, and what happened was they just cranked the van up and went on over to the next city. And we asked her, said, where did you get the water? And she said, oh, I just went out there in the woods and I prayed, and Jesus made the water container appear, look like a gas tank type can over here. And she said, and then the ground opened up and the water bubbled up, and I just filled it up. And I saw that happen down in Jamaica, too, same type thing. And so I saw food multiply, not only over there, but I saw food multiplying over here in America. At prayer meetings, we would have, and we would only expect a few people to come, and more people would come than we thought that we didn't have enough food to feed them. And so what would happen is we would just pray, and God would multiply food, and the food would never go away as long as we were feeding those people. And, you know, he fed Elijah a cake for 40 days. I said, Lord, I wish you would do that for me. Maybe I could lose some weight, which, by the way, I am losing weight. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for that. Paula, Judge Paula's lost a pile of weight, and her sisters are losing weight. You know what they did? They went up on Miracle Internet Church, and what they did up there, I have an MP3 up on there, and it's called The Spirit of Gluttony. And it's actually a tape where I'm ministering in mass deliverance to a church group about the spirit of gluttony. And when Judge Paula listened to it, she lost 35 pounds within about a month's time before I ever met her. And so those MP3s, you can pull them down. As you pull them down, what happens is you listen to them, and a lot of those deliverance tapes and miracle healing tapes and all are things that we did live in our church, and the anointing of God is on them, and it works. The anointing still works on them, just as if you're sitting in our church service, and you'll get healings and miracles, and all kinds of wonderful things happen. And so, you know, we give God the glory and the praise. And so that's the way God operates, though. You know, he loves you, and he's not a distant God. God is a God that loves you, and God says to his people, my seat, my throne is wide open to my people. It's that many of my people won't cut through so that I can help them. Just like I was talking to Marshall, you know, I've seen people that have had serious diseases, and they will say, God's going to heal me someday, and I'll pray for a miracle, and I feel the anointing of God. And then I'll say, well, did you get healed? And they'll say, no, but he's promised me. Well, you see, God is a God of now. He's not a God of tomorrow, because tomorrow never comes. It's right now that the gateway is open to his throne. He's right there with us now. There's Marshall back. Marshall, I don't think anybody can call in.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. I agree. Says faith is, now. Faith is now.
Yes.
So you're
God
right.
God is the God of now.
He's the God of today.
Yeah, that's one of the scriptures they changed in the Illuminati Bibles. The 1 Corinthians 5:7. They said Christ our Passover was sacrificed for us, which is true, but that's not what the King James says. The King James says Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us, because he's not just the I was, he's the I am. He's ever present. And that's what it says in Psalm 46, is it? He's our very present help in need. The word time is added. That's because it's irrespective of time. He's our very present help. And he is. He is.
Well, that's what we've been talking about all night long, is the God of the now and his power and how much he wants to do things for his people. It's just that his people are not asking. You know, this there's a fella that comes up on Blog Talk, and they talk about the UFOs and the giants and all of these kind of things. And every time he comes up on a certain radio program, the chat line will fill up with 500 callers, boom, within seconds. And here we are in absolute divine connection with the Lord Jesus Christ. And we have to pray for people to come and listen to this show. And now we're doing very well for this show to be an internet blog talk radio program. But what I'm talking about is if people only knew that those UFO shows and those cosmic gods and the cosmic Christ shows, those things are not going to be able to do anything for anybody except maybe put a little fear in them, because they're saying that this thing is happening very, very soon. As far as, see, what a lot of Christians don't realize, for instance, Marshall, is that the devil has a plan. And I tapped into that plan many years ago. I've never walked real closely with the UFO movement, because I just believe that those are devils. I do not believe they're aliens. And in fact, we have bound them and rebuked them and seen them just disappear. But the point being is, so I don't get involved in all of that. I can tell you that the New World Order has a plan for worldly Christians. And, of course, that plan is for worldly Christians to train them to believe in UFOs. And with the technology that they've developed scientifically, they have the blue beam that goes up into the sky, and it can shoot images, big, tall images as big as buildings of Jesus and Muhammad and all of these dead people. And it
so
can,
Jesus isn't dead. You mean the Jesus they're talking about?
No, the Jesus they're talking about. But they've got Jesus, too, for the Christians that are not real. And when they see these images up in the sky, they're going to say a UFO invasion is coming. Now, I didn't learn this stuff from the UFO people. I learned this stuff from government things that I've studied over the years, and have some articles on it on remnantradio.org under my newsletters up there. But anyway, they're going to fake a fake rapture of the church, and with the technology that they have. And, of course, nowadays a lot of people no longer believe in the rapture of the church, so they may not do that, but they have been using that blue beam. They use that blue beam
when Obama goes to these world conferences, they will flash a fake beam up into the sky and make a star appear. I've got an article up on my own Remnant, and also there's articles on the internet that you can just search out on some of this stuff. But the truth is the devil takes the Bible, and he's preaching the Bible according to what he wants people to think. But the Bible, when it's anointed, preached by men and women of God, God will open up the understanding spiritually for people to understand it. And so we're living in these perilous, dangerous times. And so, but what caused this conversation is the devil doesn't have any problems of gathering people to listen to his message. I mean, you go to the Super Bowl, and there's Lady Gaga.
Okay, good night.
And Lady Gaga is up there.
All right.
I'll turn
off.
Lady Gaga is up there doing a worldwide ritual right in front of the church and the people that go to the Super Bowl, and nobody even realizes that they just saw a worldwide satanic ritual done on television. And more people watch that Super Bowl than any other time of television. So what I'm saying is the devil does not have any problems growing a crowd. Sometimes a real Christian, it looks like God's left the tent. But no, I would rather minister, actually, Marshall, to a handful of real Christians than a whole church full of devils that are living their lives to please him. Marshall?
I hear you. I didn't hear everything you said a minute ago, but yeah, I understand what you're saying.
Yeah.
Well, the Lord talks about a remnant in the scriptures. I read it just today somewhere. I don't remember where right now, but he has a remnant, and he will always have a remnant. He has a remnant among the Jewish people. He has a remnant among, you know, the people that have been grafted in, you know, the Gentile church. So praise the Lord.
Yeah. Well, God knows that the real Christians hear his voice. Because the Bible says, my people hear my voice, a stranger, they will not follow.
Mm-hmm.
And he also realizes that they're going to follow him, because the Bible shows the Bride of Christ in the Bible. We need to do a show on the Bride of Christ one night. But it shows people following him all the way through the times of sorrows, which I think we're in right now. But the truth is that if you really know Jesus, you're not going to give him up, because you know there's no place else to go.
Amen. Well, he's our life. I mean, that would be ridiculous.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm just thinking about Peter, you know, that he spent whatever it was, more than 3.5 years or whatever it was with Jesus. He saw the miracles. He ate and drank and with the physical Jesus who was in the flesh. He heard his words. He believed in him. He said he would be willing to go to prison or die. And yet when push came to shove, Jesus said, what did he put it? When you're converted, strengthen the brethren.
Yeah.
Well, he became converted.
He had seen all the works of Jesus. He had even done some of those works, because those disciples cast out devils and healed the sick before Acts 1:8.
Right, and Peter didn't walk on the water.
Yeah, he had a lot of faith, but his flesh was weak, and he did not become strong until he received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. But even after he received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, he was still weak, because in at times, because Paul went immediately after he met Jesus. He went immediately on the road evangelizing, and then it was about 6 years later or so that he visited Jerusalem, the brethren. And so he went out under the anointing of Jesus. But the difference in Paul and, say, a lot of modern people try to do that, but they don't know the Word of God. Peter knew the Word of God because he was a scholar in the Old Testament.
You're talking about Paul.
Yeah, I'm talking about Paul. Yeah, I'm thinking about Paul going to see Peter.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm talking about Paul. Thank you. But Paul was a scholar, and so he knew the promises of the coming Messiah, and he knew and was able to interpret by the anointing and power of the Holy Ghost the Old Testament and how it fits into the New Testament like a glove. For instance, the New Testament, in the Old Testament, there's probably about 800 scriptures that talk about the coming of the Messiah. And then there's eight or more talking about Jesus returning to the earth. And so prophecy is a very vital pivotal thing in the Bible, but you have to have the anointing of God to understand those secrets, as you say.
You're right.
That's right.
That's true. But, you know, I think Peter's faith came because, you know, it talked about how in Acts, I think it was 2, that they continued in the apostles' doctrine, fellowship, the breaking of bread and prayers. And I think it's Acts 2. But they had the breaking of bread daily. And I think what they were doing was they were being filled with Jesus more and more. Because it says, of his fullness of all we received in grace for grace. And it says that grace can be seen, it says in Titus 2:11 or something, so we can see the grace of God. And when when people are looking at the elements of communion, or when that thief was hanging on the cross next to Jesus, and he looked over and he saw this bloody mess, and he said, Lord, when you come into your kingdom, remember me. He called him Lord. He admitted to his sins. He said he's going to come into his kingdom. He was confessing with his mouth that Jesus was Lord. He believed in his heart, Father God, was going to raise him from the dead even before it had happened. And he said, this day will you be in paradise with me. He had that confidence that was a God-given faith. And I think that Peter came by that. You know, in all that time of the breaking of bread and the communion day by day, because it says in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1, Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. He obtained that faith through the righteousness of God. Well, how is anybody made righteous? It's by Jesus.
Yeah.
Coming into us, and it's by his blood that we're made the righteousness of God. He loves us from our sin, washes us in his own blood. I'm more convinced. I had a little inkling of this, but I'm becoming more convinced of this, that it was that the Lord was revealing more of himself to Peter in that way and in that time. And he had such faith that people had faith in his faith, but they would bring their sick ones and hope to catch his shadow. And then it doesn't really say that the shadow of Peter healed them, but people were expecting that. And I don't think there are too many people on the earth today, or even during the great healing revivals maybe they did back then in the 40s and 50s, of people waiting to catch, you know, some great man of God's shadow. I don't think there are too many people out there, but maybe that's coming again. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, Marshall, have you ever thought about that thief on the cross, that maybe that thief was a backslidden Christian that had seen him in the masses and committed to him and then fallen away? Because, you know, the Bible shows that he anointed the 12 disciples in Matthew 10, And then in another place in Matthew, it shows him anointing 72 disciples to cast out devils and preach. And so the fact that he seemed to know those things that you just talked about he was going to be resurrected and that he was the Lord and all of that. Have you ever thought about that?
No, I had not thought about it in those terms. But he obviously knew who Jesus was.
Yeah.
You know, and how he knew that, I don't know. Whether he'd been amongst the 5,000 that had been fed and was sitting on the mountain with him for all that time, or the people that were sitting by the seashore when he was preaching to them out of the boat, or I don't know. I just don't. But, you know, he may have been one that had committed to the Lord, but maybe the seed hadn't really taken root. Because, you know, it talks about how the Word of God is the seed and how he comes to sow the seed, but the enemy comes to, first he wants to mix in other things and the cares of this world and all of these things to try and keep us from pursuing the Lord, you know.
Yes.
And that's very real. That's very, very real, because there's, you know, people have a lot of obligations in life and a lot of things that could creep in, and that scripture that's I think it's 2 Corinthians 10, so it's holding every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. Maybe sometime you can help flesh out the weapons of our warfare are not carnal but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Well, I think maybe that was what was happening tonight. But
why don't we teach on that real soon together? But before we go, what about communion? When do you want to do that again?
Well, that's up to you. I think it's it was obviously very important for the first century church, and they walked in a tremendous amount of power,
mm-hmm.
because when people have communion, they keep a very short list of problems, if you know what I mean. They get to examine their hearts, and then if they take in communion in remembrance of what Jesus did instead of what they did wrong, which is kind of the problem with some of the teaching in the church these days. But I think if people can appropriate what Jesus paid a whole lot for us, and,
mm-hmm.
and obviously Smith Wigglesworth and others, by finding out about the power of taking communion daily, that the pastor of a church in Darien, Connecticut, I met many years ago. He's probably gone home to be with the Lord. I really don't know. But he wrote a book. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning, and it was talking about a miracle in Darien. And he got to be an Episcopal priest without ever having to go to seminary because he knew the book. He lived in the book.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
And he had the power of the Holy Spirit in that church. He really had a heart for the Lord, but he said something just sort of offhanded to me that one time I met him. He said communion has become so important to him. It was like Mary hearing things, you know, the shepherds coming to say, you know, what they said in Luke 2 or wherever it is, you know, about, you know, you're going to see him wrapped in the swaddling clothes. And, you know, I mean, the shepherds came in and said this, and Mary just pondered these things in her heart. Well, that man said something about communion being so important to him. And his church was so on fire for Jesus, I thought, I wonder why that was so important for him. But that's about as far as it went for years, decades probably. The Lord planted these little seeds, but, you know, his word and these little things by his anointed servants, when they drop in, you know, if somebody has a heart, he can flesh it out. And maybe that's what happened with that thief on the cross. Maybe he heard some anointed word and it kicked in, because there he's getting ready to face eternity. And, you know, that tends to get people's attention. You know, my natural brother was not interested in things having to do with Christianity, as far as I know. He went and visited a Quaker church once or twice because we had a grandfather who'd been a Quaker, and I went and visited once. I don't know if... I met one lady who was a Quaker who seemed to love the word, and she came and spoke at my grade school, and she just read 1 Corinthians 13. And that was her message, the love chapter. And that's about all she shared. She's a lady of few words. But there obviously were Quakers back when that knew the Lord. They were called Quakers for a reason. They must have had the Holy Ghost come on them, you know. There must have been some of them
yeah.
that knew the Lord, you know. And they certainly were not interested in graven images and idols and all of that.
Yeah.
The Lord. I don't know how I got off on that, but my brother was not interested in things of the Lord, but when he found out he was given diagnosis of terminal cancer, I saw him listening to a preacher on TV in
uh-huh.
absolutely rapt attention.
Uh-huh.
And I thank God for that TV, and I thank
uh-huh.
God for whoever I don't know who the preacher was, I have no clue.
Uh-huh.
I never watched Christian television myself, not then.
Uh-huh.
I don't watch much of it now either, but he paid very close attention. And my wife had a vision that Jesus came to get him, that he went home, that he
yes.
had an opportunity to repent at the 11th hour and 59th minute and 59th second of his life. He had an opportunity to repent, and he did, and that's all we need to do is call upon the name of the Lord, and you'll be saved.
Amen.
You know?
Well, Brother Marshall, this has been wonderful tonight. It truly, I think it was more powerful than we'll ever know, and we'll find out when we get into eternity, but I believe that a lot of powers were broken tonight.
Thank you.
And I appreciate you, and we bind retaliating spirits over everyone that raised their hands and everyone that prayed and everyone that listened and everyone that will listen in the name of Jesus.
And all family members and all those connected and related to them too, in Jesus' name.
Amen. And, well, you let me know, because we can do one or the other of those, programs.
Well, you pray about it. You let me know which way you feel led. And
breaking down strongholds probably after tonight might well be the next program that we do, so that the people will understand what we just did.
Yeah, well, I'm not sure
you know?
I understand it either.
Well, I know about that. And what I can do is I can come up and do a little speech, and you'll fall right in because you know more than what you think you do.
Well, praise the Lord.
Amen.
Blessed be the Holy Spirit in me. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Well, good night, brother, and good night, everybody. God bless you.
Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. Lord, lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace in Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen. God bless you.
God bless you.
Give my love to your family and Nancy.
And to yours.
Okay.
Good night.
God bless. Bye.